filed by the American Civil Liberties Union arguing the metadata collection violates the privacy rights of Americans. The NSA collected telephone metadata under the authority of Section 215 of the USA Patriot Act, which allowed for secret court orders to collect tangible things that could be used by the government in investigation. The USA Patriot Act was enacted after the September 11th attacks to combat terrorism. Section 215 expires on June 1st. The court wrote, "The text of Section 215 cannot bear the weight the government asks us to assign to it and does not authorize the telephone metadata program."
For over 35 years, Robertson Roberts has been a trusted source for buying and selling your investment-grade precious metals. They also take Bitcoin for precious metal purchases and permanently removed the minimum purchase order for all orders paid in the digital currency. Call Robertson Roberts today for knowledgeable advice on investing and a forward-thinking approach to new technologies. 850-478-5270 or online at rrbi.co.
Reuters reports Prime Minister David Cameron's Conservatives are on track to govern Britain for another 5 years, even though they are likely to fall just short of an outright majority at Thursday's election, according to exit polling. The poll gave the Conservatives 316 of 650 seats in the lower house of Parliament, and the main opposition, Labour Party, is expected to receive 239. If accurate, that would be one of the centre-left Labour Party's worst ever results. Conservative Government Minister Michael Gove said that if the exit poll proved correct, the Conservatives have clearly won this election.
It's The Onion Radio News. General Motors reports record sales of its new disposable car. This is Doyle Redland reporting. General Motors has announced a 56% increase in earnings this year, attributing much of it to February's wildly successful launch of the GMC WHIM, the first ever non-refillable disposable automobile. Debuting at a cost of $1,100 each, the vehicles are flying out of showrooms as quickly as dealers can stock them. WHIM enthusiast Glenn Shriver.
I recently consumed four vehicles driving from my home to Daytona Beach for the first annual WHIM Owners Convention. I've already collected all eight colors.
Rival automakers are preparing to counter with their own lines of disposable cars, including the Ford Temperare and the Chrysler Dumper. The 2002 Mitsubishi Ditch will be unveiled later this year with a projected sticker price of $799. Doyle Redland for The Onion Radio News, online at theonion.com.
Oh, you're good. Here we are. It's Free Talk Live, and we are on the radio. You can talk to us about anything you want to talk about here at 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. There was some pretty big news that we did not talk about last night that I think is really important to get out there about the NSA. Of course, those of you who have been paying attention to the news over the last couple of years know that Edward Snowden, former NSA contractor, came out, I think it was the summer of 2013. He came out with some really bombshell information about the massive spying that has been perpetrated on American people and people around the world by the government agency known popularly as the NSA, the National Security Agency. They also revealed that the GCHQ, which is the Great Britain version of the NSA, and other spy agencies around the world have been basically violating their own rules and have been behaving in a very, very naughty manner. But then again, what did everybody really expect from the NSA? And I don't think anybody who's been paying attention is really surprised to find out about all of that spying. Well, now there's a sort of a bombshell court decision that has come out, and the New York Times as well as the FreeThoughtProject.com have the story. So here it is from the Free Thought Project. In a sweeping decision out of the Second Circuit Court of Appeals, the ACLU versus Clapper, the federal court has ruled that the NSA's bulk data collection program, which sweeps up millions of Americans' phone records without a warrant, to be illegal. The decision marks a major victory for civil libertarians and comes as Congress debates whether to renew the law that underpins the bulk metadata collection program. Judge Gerald Lynch, writing on behalf of the three-judge panel, called the government's rationale for bulk collection, quote, unprecedented and unwarranted, going on to say that the program exceeds the scope of what Congress has authorized. He went on to say that the government approach represented a monumental shift in our approach to combating terrorism, which was not seemingly grounded in our legal framework. The decision is the most substantial blow to the NSA's domestic spying program thus far, and the plaintiff that brought this case was the ACLU. Their attorney, in a statement to The Intercept, said, quote, "This ruling should make it clear once and for all that the NSA's bulk collection of Americans' phone records is unlawful, and it should cast into doubt the unknown number of other mass surveillance operations of the NSA that rely on a similarly flawed interpretation of the law." And so that's a big important point, is that, you know, we still probably don't know what all of their programs are. We know what Edward Snowden has revealed, but the NSA isn't interested in just opening up the books. And
no, of course not. Why would they be interested in doing something like that?
Well, right. I mean, they've already been made to look like little tyrants, and it's been pretty clear that they're able to essentially invade all of your communications if that's what they want to do.
Mm-hmm.
And this... You know, I'm not a legal expert, but obviously this particular court ruling isn't going to, you know, overturn the NSA. They still exist. The court's just saying that, oh, well, this one kind of spying on your part has been illegal. Now, the speculation here is that they're using the same excuse to do other programs, but we don't ultimately know what those other programs are. The collection... Excuse me here. In the court's opinion, one of the judges wrote, quote, "To obtain a 215 order, the government must provide the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Court with a statement of facts showing there are reasonable grounds to believe that the tangible things that are sought are relevant to an authorized investigation other than a threat assessment." Now, that court they're talking about is essentially kind of like a secretive court, and they, I'm sure, will grant whatever search warrants that the NSA wants them to grant. But by doing an end run around that court in the first place, they're very clearly breaking their own process, breaking their own rules. So the fact that they won't even, you know, they wouldn't even go through the court to get that authorization, I think really speaks to how invasive this particular program was. The collection operates under Section 215 of the Patriot Act, which authorizes the government to collect, quote, "any tangible things that the government alleges are relevant to a terror investigation." The government has used this as the basis for collecting massive amounts of digital records, and this information can be used to reveal, quote, "civil, political, or religious affiliations," says the judge, "as well as personal behavior and intimate relationships." He went on to directly rebuke the government's position in the decision, writing, quote, "The government emphasizes that relevance is an extremely generous standard, particularly in the context of the grand jury investigations to which the statute analogizes orders under Section 215. Appellants argue that relevance is not an unlimited concept and that the government's own use of the records obtained demonstrates that most of the records sought are not relevant to any particular investigation. The records demanded are all-encompassing. The government doesn't even suggest that all of the records sought, or even necessarily any of them, are relevant to any specifically defined inquiry." And how could they be if they're just collecting information wholesale on everyone's phone calls? Then how they could possibly argue that that data is relevant to any kind of specific inquiry is pretty ridiculous. And that's what the court has backed up here. Now, according to thefreethoughtproject.com, what is telling about the entire situation is that none of this would be transpiring if it were not for the revelations brought forth by Edward Snowden, which publicly revealed the existence of this megalithic program. Even lawmakers were caught by surprise at the breadth of the domestic spying in the wake of Snowden's disclosures, and even the author of the Patriot Act, Representative Jim Sensenbrenner, went on the record stating that he never intended the bill to authorize the NSA to use it to sweep up bulk data of innocent Americans. But, I mean, anybody who knows anything about politics and the way government works should know that whatever Sensenbrenner's intentions were for the Patriot Act don't ultimately matter. When government passes some program, then it's never the intentions of the lawmakers that end up being what becomes real. What ends up being, you know, in existence is whatever the bureaucrats decide. And, you know, these bureaucrats are not the same people who wrote the law. They're interpreting the law, and they'll always interpret the law in the way that gives the most power to the bureaucrats. And so over time, you know, maybe not the first year, maybe not the second year, but over 10 years, the program will morph from its original intentions to some complete bastardization, perhaps, of those original intentions. So Sensenbrenner, you know, he's acting stupid here, as though he doesn't know that government programs, you know, stray from their original parameters, if you will.
One of the big fears about Social Security back in the day was that the Social Security number would become a national ID number.
That's right.
And that everybody would have to produce their Social Security number at all their transactions. Mm-hmm. And they assured us that wasn't, well,
it
not
said
us,
it.
I wasn't born yet. But
it
but
said
they,
it on the card, actually.
Yeah, that yeah. It was not supposed to be any kind of a number. But yet, even doing business with private companies, you end up having to give them your Social Security number. And when I was in the computer mm-hmm. business, I would find people saying, well, we'll just use the Social Security number as the primary key of this database. And I would be like, why are we even collecting that data? There's absolutely no reason to have that in our database. We don't interact with the Social Security Administration.
Well, it has turned into a you know, an identification number for an individual. And that you're right, that wasn't the original intention of the program. And I don't know how many years it took to pull that off of the Social Security card, but it certainly hasn't been there in my lifetime, and I imagine it went away relatively quickly.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think it started drifting into that use within the first generation of the program.
So you that's know, a great
they
example.
They just have to wait for a few people to die off who remember what all the promises they made.
So there's been an effort to push back against NSA overreach in the form of the USA Freedom Act, which would limit certain types of bulk data collection practices while entrenching others and force the agency to request from private companies specific sets of phone records involved in a case. But not everyone believes that the current manifestation of the USA Freedom Act is a good thing, including Congressman Justin Amash saying in a Facebook post, quote, From day one following the revelation of the NSA's bulk collection program, I have said the warrantless collection of records on all Americans violates both the Fourth Amendment to the Constitution and the plain reading of Section 215 of the Patriot Act. Today's ruling by the court makes it clear the executive branch's interpretation of the statute, that is, interpreting records as relevant to a terrorism investigation, to mean all records everywhere, is unprecedented and unwarranted. In the light of this ruling, Congress must not proceed with the latest version of this USA Freedom Act. We can continue here. There's a little bit more about this, and you can share your thoughts with us. I don't imagine there's anybody out there who's upset about this court decision besides the, you know, the status in the NSA. But you're welcome to share your thoughts with us here at 855-450-FREE. There's more Free Talk Live coming up in moments.
Are you completely free of stress and fatigue? Well, of course not. You aren't alone, though. Now think about how nice it would be to begin relieving some of that stress and fatigue. Let me introduce you to a product that has and is working for me. It's called Youthful Greens. Youthful Greens. It's packed full of nature's nourishing, cleansing, and alkalizing greens, providing a powerful dose of whole food nutrition in each serving. Youthful Greens helps increase overall energy levels and reduce all that fatigue and stress on your body. And right now, when you visit freegreens.net or call 800-333-6923 and order your 1 month supply of Youthful Greens for only $29.95, you get another month's supply for free. That's 2 months of Youthful Greens for the already low price of just $29.95, plus free shipping. That's saving you $45. Visit freegreens.net today or simply call 800-333-6923. And hey, you're welcome.
This is Mark of Free Talk Live. We've been witnessing a meltdown of the economic engine that powers our country. With a printing press tethered to Washington bureaucrats and New York central bankers, how can we trust paper money? For years, I've been buying gold and silver from Midas Resources, and you should too. Call 877-357-9938 for a free book titled 10 Reasons to Own Gold, or go to gold.freetalklive.com. Again, 877-357-9938. 877-357-9938.
Farmers keep livestock lean and healthy with a mineral-rich diet. Then, before market, they cut off minerals, leaving them to crave high-calorie grains. If weight control is this easy, why prescribe surgery for humans? Introducing Youngevity. You could avoid 900 diseases by getting 90 essential nutrients from Youngevity. Check out 90 for Life at tobeyoungagain.com or call 855-79-YOUNG. That's 855-79-YOUNG or tobeyoungagain.com. Youngevity. It's all about saving money, getting healthy, and creating wealth.
There are two types of advertising. Pull advertising, like Google AdWords, where a consumer goes looking for widgets near them and you try to pull them in with your ad away from the other widget purveyors. Then there's push advertising, where you push your message out about your great widgets and attempt to convince people who weren't thinking about widgets at all that what they need in their life right now is your widget. Radio is push advertising. In the course of a week, there are probably over 250,000 good folks listening to Free Talk Live, and they could hear your message. We're having a sale right now, and it ends May 15th. 200 30-second ads for $1,997. That's like 10 bucks an ad. Find another show with that kind of rate with 150-plus stations. Email me, markedge@markatfreetalklive.com, and I'll set you up. You don't need to have an ad. We'll produce it for you. Buy 200 30-second ads by May 15th and get them for less than $10 a piece. It's a big savings, and you don't want to miss it. Email me, mark@freetalklive.com. Now, here's a chance to do a little activism while you're cruising Facebook, Twitter, or Google+. Between the LOL cats, the recipes, the hot girls, and the inspirational sunrise memes, Free Talk Live's posts pass by your newsfeed. Like them. Comment. It gives us more exposure. If you don't see our posts, click like at facebook.freetalklive.com and then hover over it to click get notifications. It's an easy way to spread the ideas of liberty a bit further. I know you're busy, but you can spare that tenth of a calorie it takes to click on something. Facebook.freetalklive.com. Radio is the most personal of mediums. I exist right now in your head. If you listen to Free Talk Live regularly, you know me. Free Talk Live is on more than 160 radio stations around the U.S. and has been downloaded on every continent around the world. Hundreds of thousands of listeners with ad packages from $600 a month to $6,000 a month. Imagine what we can do for your business, project, website, or idea. Email me, mark@freetalklive.com.
You can sign up to receive the latest about the Liberty Radio Network via our email updates at updates.lrn.fm. That's updates.lrn.fm.
Free Talk Live. Welcome to the program. Dial in toll free to bring up whatever you might like to discuss at 855-450-FREE. 855-450-3733. We've got Skype as well. Our Skype username is lrn.fm, so feel free to reach out to us in that way if you like. Joining you in our studio tonight, it's Ian here.
Rich Paul.
And Danica.
And, of course, you can join us online at freetalklive.com. You can get interactive in a variety of different ways. You can submit content there, right there on the front page of the website, and vote up or down on the stuff you like or dislike. And then other listeners voting will result in us knowing what you think is interesting. Of course, the best way to get your thoughts on the air is to call in toll-free at 855-450-FREE. Today, we use battery power so frequently on so many different things, it can be hard to keep track. But there are certain things that, you know, you want to make sure you get kept charged all day long. And like your cell phone, for instance, your smartphone. More than 60% of American adults have a smartphone, and that means that probably 60% of American adults are having trouble keeping that thing going all day, just because of the nature of the devices and how power hungry they are. If you've got the power, the Pocket Power Plus, you don't have a problem, because the Pocket Power Plus is a breakthrough in portable power technology that allows you to run electronic devices like your cell phone or your laptop. Sometimes for hours, possibly even days, if necessary. It is so powerful in some circumstances, it can actually jumpstart a car. It's got a full accessory pack that comes with the adapters you'll probably need, as well as the jumper cables. You can get your Pocket Power Plus for half off by going to pocketpowerplus9.com. That's pocketpowerplus9.com. And you can use coupon code FTL, and you'll save even more. Once again, that's pocketpowerplus9.com. We're sharing with you the story from the freethoughtproject.com, where a circuit court of appeals, I believe the second circuit court of appeals, has determined in a lawsuit brought by the ACLU that the U.S. government and their NSA domestic spying program, at least a significant chunk of it, was is perhaps, if it's still going on, illegal, and that is the bulk collection of your phone records. Millions of Americans' phone records being collected without a warrant. They're saying that's illegal because it exceeds the scope of even what, you know, ridiculous leeway was given to them by the Patriot Act. I mean, I'm no fan of the Patriot Act. That's a terrible piece of legislation that has eroded our freedoms even further. But what this court is saying that is that even in the Patriot Act, the restrictions that are in there are being violated by the NSA in this case. That they're just saying that every single phone call that they're collecting is irrelevant to some sort of an investigation. And essentially the court's saying that, yeah, sorry, but that's ridiculous to claim that basically every phone record is relevant to a terror investigation. When you apply for a warrant for something, which they weren't doing, which was another violation, you know, you're supposed to be kind of specific about what it is that you're seeking and the reasons for which you're seeking that information. So they're not even applying to the secret court in this case. They're just ignoring all of that and collecting bulk data. And of course, as was pointed out here by the Free Thought Project, we wouldn't have known had it been had it not been for Edward Snowden taking the personal risk and ultimate very difficult situation of coming out of the closet and blowing the whistle on these people.
And this is behavior that began during the Bush administration and continued during the Obama administration?
As I understand it, yeah.
Yeah, because they passed the Patriot Act.
What, after 2001?
2001 after the 2002? Twin Towers fell. So that was during the...
So it's been nonpartisan digging.
Oh, yeah.
Because people think that the Democrats are different with this stuff, but they,
no, they're just
Obama
the same.
Seems to be following the Bush agenda pretty closely.
Oh, yeah. Obama totally, is back in the NSA. And it was Obama who was essentially the defendant in this case because he's the head of the executive agencies. NSA is one of those.
Yeah. I mean, you would think that being such a constitutional scholar himself, he would have taken one look at this program and said, oh, gee, we can't do this. Seems like he should have known.
Justin Amash continuing here. He says, in light of this ruling, Congress must not proceed with the latest version of the USA Freedom Act. While limiting certain types of bulk collection, the latest USA Freedom Act would authorize bulk collection of Americans' records for the first time, thereby undoing some of the process, or the progress, rather, resulting from the Second Circuit's decision. Instead, Congress should pass and the president should sign the original USA Freedom Act as introduced in 2013 before amendments that protects the liberty and privacy of all Americans while providing the intelligence community the authority necessary to deal with those who seek to harm us. Now, I'm no fan of this Justin Amash character or anything like that. He's just the one included in this particular article here by the Free Thought Project. I guess he's sort of one of the more liberty-leaning people in Congress, but whatever that means, I don't know. I know, I can hear the code words in what he's saying, the idea that, the intelligence community still needs authority to deal with those who seek to harm us. He's not talking about freedom here. He's talking about, well, we want to give them some powers, but not as much as, the president wants them to have. Mm. And obviously, I'd like to see the NSA abolished entirely.
That'd be nice.
Yeah. I don't feel like we need them to keep us safe. Do you guys?
No, I'm a great believer in militias. I don't think we need a standing army, so I definitely don't think we need an NSA.
Show me some success stories of the NSA. For once, maybe it might give way to some thinking about it, but no, I don't think that they've done really any good.
Yeah, that's an excellent question. I mean, what are the NSA success stories?
There's Party and the... Oh, it was CIA, not NSA, sorry. It was a song by Weird Al Yankovic. It was Party and the CIA. I was going to say, well, they made a good song of it, but we're talking about the CIA, not the NSA. So it still stands. I haven't seen anything successful come from the NSA.
Yeah, back in the Clinton era, I think the CIA celebrated its 50th anniversary, and one of the late night talk show hosts said that Clinton had made a statement praising the CIA for all of its accomplishments and that the CIA would neither confirm nor deny any of those accomplishments.
So as the Free Thought Project wraps this up, he says there's a major debate taking place in Congress as Section 215 of the Patriot Act is scheduled to expire at the end of this month. The decision will send the case back to the district court for further proceedings consistent with this opinion. While this is a wonderful first step towards reigning in the NSA, the warning by Congressman Amash is extremely prescient and must be taken very seriously. Additionally, the question remains, will any of those involved in these illegal activities be held accountable? And of course, I think the answer is pretty obvious.
No.
Of course not.
No, they're just going to slap on the wrist.
No, I mean, they're not even going to be identifiable. Why would the NSA... bother to reveal who it would be that is responsible for this secret program.
Right.
I mean, they never once applied for a warrant to, you know, from a secret court. They never applied for the secret court warrant to do any of this spying. So nobody's name's on a dotted line of any kind of even a secret document in this case.
Mm-hmm.
They're going to protect their own all the way to the end, whatever that is going to look like. And then there's they link to the 97-page long decision here by the United States Second Circuit Court of Appeals. And I'll link to this over on our Facebook and the Twitter as well. So you can check this out and dig in here as deep as you darn well please. We'll continue here in moments. 855-450-FREE is the toll-free number. Coming up, one lady is pretty upset after her Florida license labeled her incorrectly as a sex offender.
Very incorrectly.
That's on the way. Plus, another example, another terrible example of why you should not be calling the police on your kids. It's Free Talk Live. More coming up.
Positive results from satisfied customers of Heart and Body Extract continue to pour into our website, hbextract.com.
This is Al from New Jersey. One day I saw your ad for Heart and Body Extract, and it mentioned that it would help me with angina, so I decided to order. I figure I had nothing to lose.
Heart and Body Extract supplies your body with everything it needs to balance itself and maintain optimal heart and circulatory health with no negative side effects.
I took the formula 3 times a day as directed, and I kid you not, within 4 days, my angina pain was completely gone.
Order HB Extract by calling 866-295-5305 or online at hbextract.com. That's 866-295-5305 or hbextract.com.
I could not believe it actually stopped the pain. Heart and Body Extract actually works. This is just an amazing product. Even the numbness in my hands is completely gone.
Heart and Body Extract, for a long and healthy life.
Free Talk Live.
I spent 8.5 years of my life in prison, and I blame it squarely on the shoulders of Christianity and the stories that I was told. If somebody, if my parents, if the people at the Christian school, if the people at church would have just explained morality to me as opposed to explaining heaven and hell as a reason for doing what was right and what was wrong, I think I would have understood. It's relatively easy. If you do the moral thing in life, your life is going to be better. You're going to sleep better at night. You're going to probably be much more prosperous.
Right.
You know, they say crime doesn't pay. They say it for a reason.
Happen right here in this world. We don't have to wait for an afterlife to experience the consequences of our actions, whether good or bad, you know?
If I would have just been given the gift of morality instead of the gift of some silly, crazy story, I would never have gone to prison.
Free Talk Live, 7 nights a week from 7 to 10 Eastern, live on the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM.
If there was a place that liberty-minded people had been elected to political positions and were rolling back government, would you move there? If freedom lovers had secured a 20% voting block and can veto most bad bills, would you move? Well, the time has come to sign the pledge at freestateproject.org. These things have happened in New Hampshire, and you can join us and help. freestateproject.org. Sign up now at freestateproject.org.
So you've heard all 3 hours of the latest episode of Free Talk Live, and you're still hungry for liberty-oriented audio content? Did you know that we have another 24/7 audio stream at LRN.FM? The Liberty Radio Network airs the latest episodes of some of the best liberty-oriented podcasts on the internet, around the clock. In addition to recorded content, you'll also hear live shows like Free Talk Live, originating from our Keene, New Hampshire studio. So listen anytime at LRN.FM. That's LRN.FM.
Hi, I'm Derek J. I don't want a politician to represent me. To me, government is the idea that one group of people can coerce everyone to comply with an edict or face increasing punishments up to and including death. Despite perhaps the most noble of intentions, the best government services are a far cry from what could be provided for by voluntary interactions. Besides, the people who call themselves the government wage wars and put peaceful people in jail for crimes involving no victims. If Starbucks used some of its money to drop bombs, I wouldn't shop there. So why would I support the American Empire? The Empire does not require my consent.
Derek J's Victimless Crime Spree. Watch it for free and order the Director's Cut DVD at victimlesscrimespree.com. That's victimlesscrimespree.com.
What's up next? Visit the Liberty Radio Network program guide to find out at shows.lrn.fm. That's shows.lrn.fm.
It's Free Talk Live. You're invited here to dial in toll-free to join us on the radio waves. 855-450-FREE is the number. That's 855-450-3733. There's some bad news in the world of digital currency, at least for one of the digital currencies out there. Not Bitcoin. Bitcoin's still going strong. Everything is good, as far as I can tell, in the Bitcoin world. In fact, the price point of Bitcoin sort of up a little bit over the last, let's say, over the last week. Right
it's
now,
it's over 250. It's been at
no,
250?
Not right now. 244, according to Bitfinex. But it's getting there. I mean, it's right around that range.
Yeah, definitely. It's been staying strong the last week.
It peaked up at 249 today. You can go and get Bitcoin for yourself, as well as some of the altcoins like Litecoin or Dogecoin, over at ExpressCoin.com. Whether you're in the U.S. or Canada, go to ExpressCoin.com, and you can get your cryptocurrency with either money order or check. And it's fast, safe, easy, and inexpensive. And ExpressCoin is a licensed money services business. You can do it from your smartphone via their app or just go straight to their website at ExpressCoin.com. And you can also use coupon code FTL. You'll get up to $40 worth of cryptocurrency with no fee at all. That's ExpressCoin.com with coupon code FTL. Now, when you go and you look up the altcoins out there, and there are a number of them, you look at altcoins and you'll see, if you go to, for instance, altcoins.com, I believe is the site that shows you hundreds of them. Nope, I'm sorry, I'm wrong. It's not altcoins.com. It's coinmarketcap.com. This is one of the most interesting sites out there for those who are interested in looking at these altcoins. So Bitcoin is a decentralized currency that is not issued by any bank or government. It was created by actually someone who's anonymous. They call themselves Satoshi Nakamoto. And Satoshi released Bitcoin to the world, about 6 years ago now?
About 6 years, yeah.
At this point. And there have been, ever since, and Bitcoin's become much more popular ever since then, going from, you know, a fraction of a penny in value for one Bitcoin up to, as we mentioned, around $250, $245.
At the height, I believe it was around 1,000.
1,100, yeah.
1,100, okay.
So it's been pretty high up, and now it's been hovering at around the 250, 230 range for several weeks. So there are alternatives to Bitcoin, though, that started coming out not too long after Bitcoin became popular. Litecoin, of course, is one of the more noteworthy ones, as I think was one of the first to market after Bitcoin. And Litecoin is currently now the number three most popular currency, according to the coin market cap. Now, they're organizing this list. I'm not sure how they determine which one's in the second place versus which one is in the third place. I think it's actually the market cap, meaning that there's $57 million worth of Litecoin, I believe, in existence. I think that's what the market cap is.
Gotcha.
I'm not an economics, you know, investor type. But the number two kind of alternative to Bitcoin is something called Ripple. Now,
really? Number two?
Yeah. Their market cap is supposedly $238 million-something dollars worth of Ripple.
Do any of you know about this? I'd never heard of it.
You've never heard of Ripple before?
No.
I've heard the name. I don't know anything about it.
Yeah, I got to say, I don't know a whole lot about it either. I've seen it before, you know, on these lists. It's always been relatively popular, and it seemed like the Ripple thing is a little different from Bitcoin. Like, a lot of these things seem to be kind of based on Bitcoin. I never really got that from Ripple, but honestly, I've never taken the time to really see what makes it different. There is a company that's behind Ripple. And I think that is one of the things that has led to its sort of, it would be premature to say that it's downfall, but it's in trouble. The company behind Ripple just got a $700,000 fine issued to it by the U.S. Financial Crimes Enforcement Network. The story coming from sovereignman.com, where they have issued the first ever civil enforcement action against a virtual currency. The offending criminal mastermind in this case is Ripple Labs. And if you're not familiar, Ripple is a virtual currency platform that was once the darling of Silicon Valley, attracting top venture capital firms like Google Ventures and Andreessen Horowitz. Ripple's technology allows users to conduct financial transactions with one another, sending and receiving payments in cryptocurrencies like Bitcoin, as well as fiat currency. Imagine Bitcoin meets PayPal, and you have the basic idea of Ripple.
I see. Okay.
As part of its technology, the parent company, Ripple Labs, also created a native virtual currency called XRP, which is the second largest in the world after Bitcoin when measured by market capitalization. Because of all these features, Ripple Labs qualifies as a, quote, money services business, according to FinCEN, which makes them subject to all sorts of regulations. And at the top of that list is the Bank Secrecy Act, which, contrary to its name, requires banks and money services businesses to betray their customers' financial secrets to the U.S. federal government. Specifically, the Bank Secrecy Act mandates that all banks and MSBs file, quote, suspicious activity reports if they know, suspect, or have reason to suspect that a transaction of $2,000 or more is so-called suspicious. And in the age of the USA Patriot Act, suspicious transactions are big business for Uncle Sam. Last year, a record 2.4 million suspicious activity reports were filed, and that's a 40% increase from 2013's record year of 1.7 million of these suspicious activity reports. Now, a lot of these things are being filed by banks.
Yes, so that's correct.
When you go in and you deposit $2,000 one day and $2,000 a day later and another $2,000.
It sets up a flag on your account, and the teller or the manager, whoever happens to be running the transaction, is required to file that out.
And so that apparently is one of the reasons why Ripple is in trouble here. We can talk more about what's happening to them in a moment. But first, let's go to John. He's in San Francisco. John, you're on Free Talk Live with Ian, Rich, Paul, and Danica.
Hi, how you doing? I've listened for a very long time, even back in the Manwich days.
Wow, thanks, John.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, but I need to change the subject. The reason why I'm calling is because I just wanted to run something past you guys and let you know. I don't know if you're familiar with the Candace Conti pedophilia case that went on in San Francisco.
No, Candace who? Conti?
Conti, spelled C-O-N-T-I. You can Google and check it out. But there's a gentleman out here who I happen to be good friends with who actually created a ballot measure, a proposed law to prevent religious organizations from being able to hide behind the First Amendment, covering up possible pedophile crimes that happen within their church organization.
I don't understand what you're getting at. I mean, covering up, you're talking about Catholic, like the Catholic Church? Is this Candace Conti a religious situation?
Yeah, it was a religious situation. She was a part of, she was one of Jehovah's Witnesses at one time, and she was being molested by one of their shepherds or elders or whatever they're called.
Okay.
And they had basically spent a great deal of time trying to cover it up. And I don't know if you've seen the documentary, but it was quite interesting because they got a lot of these, you know, high up people within the Jehovah's Witness organization, and they basically said on the witness stand that they were told to lie and cover this up, which then caused this law or ballot measure to be put on the ballot. And I just wanted to mention it. It's ballot measure 15-0023, which anyone can look up on the California ballot measure.
And what are you saying this measure is supposed to do? I'm not real clear on that.
Well, what it is it's designed, they were trying to conceal facts about the pedophilia, and they were doing it hiding behind the First Amendment, saying that whatever goes on within a religious organization is ecclesiastical privilege, and we don't have to report anything to any authority-based government entity. And
well,
that's how they
I think, I mean, maybe you haven't, I don't know, I haven't read what you're talking about, this ballot measure, but generally, when it comes to a courtroom situation, it's not the First Amendment that protects your right not to speak. It's the Fifth Amendment, but that's only protection against self-incrimination. The Fifth Amendment does not protect against being forced to testify in a criminal matter. So,
but clergymen do have a privilege. For example, a Catholic priest cannot be forced to testify something that he has heard in the confessional. He's legally privileged.
That's a very good point.
from being forced to testify, and the Church of the Invisible Hand is doing mediation under the seal of the confessional in order to take advantage of that.
Stand by, John. Right, we can come back here, because I'm still a little confused at, you know, what the First Amendment has to do with, you know, alleged case of child molestation, because that probably didn't happen inside the confessional. It sounds to me like it's a conspiracy in this church to cover that up. More coming up. It's Free Talk Live.
There are two types of advertising. Poll advertising, like Google AdWords, where a consumer goes looking for widgets near them and you try to pull them in with your ad away from the other widget purveyors. Then there's push advertising, where you push your message out about your great widgets and attempt to convince people who weren't thinking about widgets at all that what they need in their life right now is your widget. Radio is push advertising. In the course of a week, there are probably over 250,000 good folks listening to Free Talk Live, and they could hear your message. We're having a sale right now, and it ends May 15th. 200 30-second ads for $1,997. That's like 10 bucks an ad. Find another show with that kind of rate with 150-plus stations. Email me, markedge at markatfreetalklive.com, and I'll set you up. You don't need to have an ad. We'll produce it for you. Buy 200 30-second ads by May 15th and get them for less than $10 a piece. It's a big savings, and you don't want to miss it. Email me, mark at freetalklive.com, now.
If the IRS has garnished your paycheck or seized money from your bank account, you need to get professional tax help now. Fast action is required to put a halt to these aggressive IRS collection tactics. You can count on the knowledgeable team of tax professionals at Wall & Associates. With over 30 years of experience, Wall & Associates has settled the tax problems of thousands of taxpayers for a small fraction of what they owed. For a free face-to-face consultation, call 1-800-425-4610 to put a wall between you and the IRS. 1-800-425-4610 or look for us on the web at wallandassociates.net. We solve tax problems. If you hire Wall & Associates today, you'll never have to talk to the IRS again. To stop the levies and seizures today, take action now. Call Wall & Associates at 1-800-425-4610. Wall & Associates, 1-800-425-4610. Based on actual cases, results may vary, not a solicitation for legal services.
Here's a breaking medical legal alert. Attention, users of the diabetes drug Actos. If you or a loved one has taken Actos, then developed bladder cancer, or if a loved one has died from bladder cancer after taking Actos, you may be entitled to significant financial compensation from the pharmaceutical giants who made these drugs. Our experienced attorneys are dedicated to help you get the money you're entitled to, but time may be running out on this opportunity. So you must call today. The information is free. There are no fees unless we win your case. If you or a loved one has developed bladder cancer or something worse after taking the diabetes drug Actos, call right now and learn your legal rights. This is an advertisement not valid in all states. I am a paid non-attorney spokesperson. Call the Tort Attorneys 24/7 right now. 800-430-7924. 800-430-7924. That's 800-430-7924.
DVD, books, music, instruments, periodicals, computers, software, electronics, photo, cell phone, office products, home and garden, bed and bath, furniture, kitchen, pet supplies, automotive, hardware, apparel, shoes, jewelry, grocery, healthcare, sports and outdoors, toys, games, used and more. It's a department store at your fingertips. Shop.freetalklive.com. Get all your shopping done, get a great deal, and a portion of your purchase goes to benefit Free Talk Live when you enter Amazon via shop.freetalklive.com.
This Your Family Today tip is brought to you by Stouffer's, helping bring your family together with wholesome dinner options, even on the busiest of nights. Find dinner table ideas to bring your family together at letsfixdinner.com. To get kids involved in dinner time conversation, ask specific questions, not broad ones. Instead of what happened today at school, try what was the best thing that happened today. The more specific you are, the more they'll have to say. For more tips like these, visit us at parenthood.com/yourfamilytoday.
If you enjoy LRN.FM, please contribute to your favorite shows via their websites and become an amplifier at amp.lrn.fm. That's amp.lrn.fm.
This is Free Talk Live. Dial toll-free. Join us here, 855-450-FREE. That's It's 855-450-3733. You can join us online over at freetalklive.com. Please enjoy the features that we have waiting for you on the site. And if you like the show and you want to help support Free Talk Live, you can shop with us. Just go to shop.freetalklive.com. Enter Amazon through the links you'll find there, and you can get all kinds of neat stuff over there at Amazon. I was just on Amazon looking at some mosquito repellent refills. I guess repellent's not the right word. Attractant. These are the refills for those zappers, the mosquito zapper things.
Refills for the zappers?
Yeah, the zapper thing.
They're not powered by electricity or anything?
There's actually some sort of chemical that, I guess some of them are electric only, but others have the zappy thing, and there's some sort of a chemical that is in there as well to attract
that does make sense.
So that's what I was looking at on Amazon today. You can go and grab whatever you need over at shop.freetalklive.com. Now, John is still with us here in California. John, you were telling us about a ballot measure that I don't know how many signatures they have for this yet, but is this thing qualified yet? What's the status on this?
Yeah, it's qualified, and now it's actually, yeah, now we're trying to get the signatures. A petition will be set up online. Let me explain to you the First Amendment issue, which in the First Amendment, it says that there has to be a separation between church and state. And a lot of religious organizations will then use that as a defense. So.
That's not exactly what it says. It says Congress shall pass no law either establishing a state religion, which is not the exact wording there, or abridging the free exercise of religion. So there's two parts.
Right. Usually most religious groups will use that as a type of immunity, and that's what the Watchtower have been doing. They've been using it as a type of immunity, basically saying you can't, you know, and investigate us because this is a religious matter and it happened, you know, under the auspices of our organization. And that's what they had been using for years to try to avoid any kind of legal action. Ms. Conte had
Now, has that worked?
Lawyer.
I mean, what you're referring to is a case called Candace Conte versus Watchtower Bible Tract Society. Ended up happening in that case? Were they able to...
She won. She was able to prove that they had suppressed information. She was able to prove that they had systematically acted collusively together to try to conceal facts.
So why do you feel like this law that would essentially take away First Amendment protections is what you're saying from religious people is even necessary? They didn't even win. I mean, this lady won the case, right?
Yeah, traditionally speaking, the Watchtower has always won every case that they've – this is like kind of a historic point. It had never happened before or prior. And looking at the way that they approached their defense and what they were trying to do, it became clear that they were trying to use the First Amendment as the type of immunity. So the ballot measure basically states, you know, you have your right to religious secrecy and whatnot in your doctrine, but you cannot, when it comes to criminal matters, try to use the First Amendment as a type of immunity to hide behind. It just clarifies and basically streamlines the position of what a religious organization can or can't do. And that's why I just wanted to put it out there. And, you know, you can go to the California Initiative website, download the PDF and check it out for yourself. It's designed to protect people.
Well, yeah, I don't agree.
Yeah, obviously I don't have detailed knowledge of this measure. It's the first that I've heard
of it. I've got it here. It's very lengthy. It's two full pages.
What it sounds like to me is that they're trying to chip away at the traditional rights of religion and use the children as an excuse, as they frequently do. Mm-hmm. And I would not necessarily call this a pro-liberty measure, although, like I say, I have not completely analyzed it, but this sounds like an anti-liberty measure, especially given that the apparent malefactors were eventually brought to justice using existing tools. The question is, then, why do those need to be expanded? Right. It sounds like a solution in search of a problem.
Yeah, John, by the way, hasn't said anything about this being pro-liberty. He said this is, like, good for whatever. I mean, so he supports this, but we don't know what John's particular viewpoint is.
My viewpoints are, you know, I don't want to see anyone hurt or taken advantage of in the name of religion. That's basically what it comes down to.
Well, have you read this thing, John? Because it's fairly detailed, and it doesn't just have to do with what you're saying that it has to do with. Like, here's...
Yeah, I know.
I would suggest rereading the First Amendment also so you know exactly what it says, because the phrase separation of church and state isn't there.
Section G here in this, again, lengthy, there's sections all the way up through J in this, what is supposed to be a ballot measure. I imagine they're not going to print all of this on the ballot. So they'll likely give people a summary on the ballot of what this does, which is not going to be detailed enough because there's a lot here, and then expect people who are going to the polls to have taken the time to have read all two pages of this entire measure. But just here's one section of it. Quote, any religious organization that lobbies political figures or governmental agencies, either by third party, proxy, or utilizing outside paid or unpaid lobbyists to further their interest, whether political or not, can no longer be viewed as a religious entity. As such, said religious organization should have its tax status rescinded based on the First Amendment of the Constitution of the United States, as obtaining political influence conflicts with the very nature of the First Amendment. This is an incredibly confused statement here. It's essentially saying that if you are in a religious organization and you attempt to influence the government, that we will pull your status as a religious organization because somehow you attempting to influence the government conflicts with the First Amendment. I'm sorry, that's part of the First Amendment, is being able to say what you want to these government agents.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, you every organization has to be able to protect itself from government overreach, and that includes lobbying, that includes protesting, includes all kinds of things. And it actually reminds me of what they're trying to do to the Shire Free Church, to say, oh, you're not religious because you have political beliefs, and therefore we get to tax you. It seems like exactly what they said about us.
Yeah, I mean, John, this really seems like, I mean, again, I haven't taken the time to read both of these pages full of text, but I mean, this seems like just an all-out attack on freedom of religion to me.
And that's why you guys are here.
What's that supposed
because
to
mean? Everybody's got an opinion, and everybody can look at things at a different angle. And just because one person interprets something one way doesn't mean someone else.
Well, there's only one way you can interpret that particular statement. I mean, that comes right out and says anybody who's in a religious organization that goes and lobbies the government for something or tries to influence a politician is no longer qualified as a religious organization anymore. So you have to keep in, if this passes, religious organizations would have no ability whatsoever to have an opinion publicly about pending legislation or, you know, political matters.
The Catholic Church would no longer be able to lobby with regard to abortion. And although I disagree with the Catholic Church on abortion, I'm pro-choice, they're obviously pro-life, they have a right to try and make their viewpoint heard.
Yeah, I would say anybody that supports free speech should oppose this thing that you're putting out there, John. And good luck, though. Thanks for the call tonight. 855-450-FREE. That's the toll-free number here. 855-450-3733. I mean, I could go on and try to dig up some more from this thing here, but... let's see. Here's another one. Any religious organization, this is Section C, that does not report any act that could be a chargeable offense under the penal code immediately to the proper authorities without delay shall lose its tax-exempt status.
So that would include you and me not reporting people smoking weed in church?
That's correct.
Wow. Yeah. See, they smoke weed at the Church of the Invisible Hand, and I'm no snitch. I ain't reporting nothing to nobody.
Exactly. I mean, this is I'll go on here. The claim that
somebody's touching kids, I'm going to report it. Don't get me wrong.
Right.
But... they say
any criminal act under the penal code. The claim that, quote, any matters of criminal nature may arise within a religious organization are protected by either the confidentiality of a confession or by the claim of handling the matter internally amongst the religious leaders of said organization is not valid. Alleged criminal acts such as pedophilia and or fraud of any type cannot be protected by ecclesiastical privilege, as criminal acts have nothing to do with religious doctrine. So once again, if somebody's actually harming another person, if whether it's some child that's being molested or somebody that's being, you know, sacrificed on some sort of satanic altar or whatever,
They were really scared about that in the 80s. I remember that in the Reagan administration. Everybody thought people were doing satanic rituals in all the cemeteries.
I was in elementary school in the 80s, and I remember stories about that going on.
It's not just satanic. It's also druidic, too, to do human sacrifices. So
really?
Yes. Well, and Aztec, Mayan. Absolutely. There's been a lot of human sacrifice over the years.
So
Church of the Invisible Hand doesn't do it.
This law is terrible. This law guts the First Amendment. This law does not protect free speech. It just basically destroys the idea of freedom of religion as well. And terrible idea here. This is, section 15-0023 coming up on a ballot probably in 2016 in California. More coming up.
In a trial by jury, the primary function of a juror is not to dispense punishment to the accused. It is to protect your fellow citizens from being unjustly deprived of their life, liberty, or property. As a juror, you can say no to unjust laws and prevent government abuses of power by refusing to convict. Legislative, executive, judicial. The fourth branch of government is we the people. Find out more from the Fully Informed Jury Association at fija.org.
This is Shaquille O'Neal.
And the Shaquettes.
Reminding you that anytime.
Anytime.
Is a good time.
Good time.
For the cooling, drying, freshening of Gold Bond Powder Spray. Like after the gym.
Or a crowded elevator ride.
Or golf.
Or working with
hard day's work.
Like sports casting?
You said it, ladies. Stay cool with Gold Bond Powder Spray.
Stay cool with Gold Bond.
Are you a political activist who does things that the government might not like? Then this free ebook may save your life. Rats is your guide to protecting yourself against snitches, informers, informants, agents provocateur, narcs, finks, and similar vermin. Rats was written by OG libertarian Claire Wolfe. Rats is a short book, easy to read, and available free in many formats. Download Rats free at rats-nosnitch.com. That's rats-nosnitch.com.
The three most important things you can do for Free Talk Live are, one, share one episode a week on Facebook or in some other social networking site. Two, buy the things you buy online through shop.freetalklive.com. Three, give $5 a month to the AMP program. It's my firm belief that Free Talk Live's AMP program is the best use of your charitable dollar among liberty-oriented organizations. Support all the organizations you love. But make sure you give $5 a month to AMP at amp.freetalklive.com.
You're listening to the live edition of Free Talk Live. Hour number two is next after the news here on the Liberty Radio Network at lrn.fm.
From Keene in the Shire, the Liberty Media capital of the world, this is Daryl W. Perry, host of FPP Radio News for Friday, May 8th, 2015. Silver is trading at $16.29 per ounce. Gold is valued at $1,182 per ounce. And according to BitcoinAverage.com, the average price of Bitcoin is $239. Antiwar.com reports in a 98-1 vote, the Senate yesterday passed a bill that will give them veto power over the P5+1 nuclear deal with Iran. The lone no vote was from ultra-hawkish Senator Tom Cotton from Arkansas, who was angry that his amendments were not approved. The bill has been somewhat watered down from what was initially proposed, and President Obama had said he will sign it, though at this point the overwhelming majority is veto-proof anyhow. The House of Representatives will be the next to debate the bill, with a vote expected there next week. Though there probably will not be any serious obstacles to the vote passing there either, it could face another round of attempts to add amendments aimed at killing the negotiations outright. Senate hawks are expressing hope that even this watered-down bill will effectively do that anyhow, saying they believe that Congress would not approve the deal as presently written and will insist on improvements that will themselves almost certainly be unacceptable to the rest of the nations involved. The lone senator to abstain was Barbara Boxer from California.
FPP Radio News is brought to you by Coinbase. Coinbase is a simple and secure online Bitcoin wallet for sending, receiving, and storing Bitcoin. Get started at coinbase.fppradio.com. That's coinbase.fppradio.com.
UPI reports a federal appeals court ruled the NSA's collection of telephone metadata on millions of Americans is not authorized by the USA Patriot Act, making it illegal. The SCOPE program was first uncovered by whistleblower and former NSA contractor Edward Snowden in 2013, sparking a debate about privacy, security, and the reach of government surveillance. The court ruled in response to a lawsuit filed by the American Civil Liberties Union arguing the metadata collection violates the privacy rights of Americans. The NSA collected telephone metadata under the authority of Section 215 of the USA Patriot Act, which allowed for secret court orders to collect tangible things that could be used by the government in investigation. The USA Patriot Act was enacted after the September 11th attacks to combat terrorism. Section 215 expires on June 1st. The court wrote, "The text of Section 215 cannot bear the weight the government asks us to assign to it and does not authorize the telephone metadata program."
For over 35 years, Roberts & Roberts has been a trusted source for buying and selling your investment-grade precious metals. They also take Bitcoin for precious metal purchases and permanently removed the minimum purchase order for all orders paid in the digital currency. Call Roberts & Roberts today for knowledgeable advice on investing and a forward-thinking approach to new technologies. 850-478-5270 or online at rrbi.co.
Reuters reports Prime Minister David Cameron's Conservatives are on track to govern Britain for another 5 years, even though they are likely to fall just short of an outright majority at Thursday's election, according to exit polling. The poll gave the Conservatives 316 of 650 seats in the lower house of Parliament, and the main opposition, Labour Party, is expected to receive 239. If accurate, that would be one of the centre-left Labour Party's worst ever results. Conservative Government Minister Michael Gove said that if the exit poll proved correct, the Conservatives have clearly won this election. Such a result means Britain is likely to face a historic in-out European Union membership referendum in the next 2 years, and that billions of pounds will be cut from government spending to eliminate the budget deficit in the world's fifth largest economy. UK election exit polls have a good track record, but the large number of parties competing this time has raised the potential for error. It will be well into Friday before final results are announced. The poll, conducted by Britain's national broadcasters, suggests Cameron will have multiple options to form a government, perhaps with the support of either the Liberal Democrats, his current coalition partners, or Northern Irish Unionist, or both. He could also try and go it alone. The same poll said the Scottish National Party would win 58 of Scotland's 59 seats, all but wiping out Labour in its former stronghold. SNP leader Nicola Sturgeon said the exit poll's prediction should be treated with huge caution. This has been FPP Radio News, online at fppradio.com.
From the creation of the Bible in 1912 by a struggling Baltimore book salesman to the day in 1493 when Christopher Columbus and his crew looked back on their voyage and realized what they truly discovered was themselves, The Onion looks back at This Week in History. On July 21st, 1969, astronaut Neil Armstrong became the first human to set foot on the surface of the moon. The f***ing moon, for Christ's sake.
This is Tranquility Base. The Eagle has landed. Jesus H. Christ, Houston. We're on the f***ing moon. Over.
Roger, Tranquility. We copy that. We cannot believe you are on the f***ing moon.
I'm descending the ladder. Just one more step and I'm... holy living f**k. I absolutely am standing on the surface of the f**king moon. Jesus H. Christ in a chicken basket.
This is the Onion News Network.
This is Free Talk Live. Coming up, Christian swinger. Since we were talking about religion a moment ago, I've never seen this story before, but we've got it here from, of all sites, christiantoday.com. What are Christian swingers? Are they for real? We'll get into that here in a moment. With you in studio, you've got Ian here.
Rich Paul.
And Danica.
Jumping right into your calls and thoughts. Let's start with Tom in Nashua. Tom, you're on Free Talk Live. Go ahead.
Yeah, the Islamic State, they have been recruiting people from around the world to go and join the Islamic State, and they question is, like, how to stop them. I mean, they come up with these propaganda campaigns on the Islamic State, and you get people who are vulnerable, and they read up on this stuff, and they think that, hey, that'd be a good idea. And one of the things that it's kind of like during the Second World War when the Japanese soldiers invaded Korea, and they were allowed to go ahead and rape the Korean girls, and that was an incentive for those guys. And that's going on now, because when they raid towns, there's a lot of that going on. But the other thing is like, if you're trying to argue with somebody who's talking about joining ISIS, think about the absurdity of the arguments against it. No, no, Johnny, you should stay in the United States, where there's liberty and justice for all.
Well, anyone can look at the news of ISIS and think, okay, why would I want to associate with an organization that promotes violence and killing? But I mean, why do people still end up joining it? Just a few months ago, there were two girls from Serbia, I believe it was, that ran away from home and joined ISIS. And I believe one of them made it home. The other one, we don't know where she is. Why would anyone join ISIS?
Well, if you're a religious nut,
joining with other religious nuts might be attractive. And personally, I would rather ISIS have our religious nuts than America have our religious nuts. I think that maybe a good idea is to let them set up an area where they can practice Sharia law all they want. And if other Muslims want to live under Sharia law, you have some place to tell them to go. Great. Go live with ISIS. Go away.
Just to clarify, from our conversations with the guys from Muslims for Liberty, Will Cauley, and Davi Barker, Sharia law isn't what it's represented to be in the mainstream U.S. media, like you might see on Fox News or whatever. Sharia law goes over stuff like, you know, so Sharia law can include, you know, what is the appropriate way to wash one's feet? Sharia law would include all kinds of things that don't have to do with, like, oppression of people, I guess.
I would argue that as soon as you start enforcing laws on how to wash your feet, you are oppressing people who want to wash their feet.
Sure, and I'm not saying, but
as I say, if you agree to consent to Sharia law, then I don't have a problem with you living under Sharia law.
Right. No, that's what I was going to say. Exactly. There may be some Muslims who want to impose Sharia law on everyone.
Yeah.
But those would be the radicals, right? Most Muslims just want to have Sharia law because that's their religion and that's their own personal
thing. And when I say that I would like to see Islamists, which I define as people who want to impose Sharia law on unconsenting others, when I say that I would like to see them leave the country, I am not saying that I would like to see all Muslims leave the country, because, you know, just like I was raised in a very mellow sect of Christianity that didn't really want to impose anything on anybody. You know, they were pro-choice and they were pro-gay, and, you know, they just really didn't care about any of that stuff. And so, you know, that to me is just fine. If there's a, you know, a mellow version of Islam that leaves other people alone and says, but you should follow these laws to be a good person, then I say more power to you. You should have a moral code.
I think that's most of Islam is, you know, a peaceful, peace-loving group of people.
I would agree.
All the evidence points to it, right?
But then you do see groups that act differently.
And of course.
Those are the ones that, if they want to live under that sort of system, I would say, I hope there's some place that they can do it that
would not be imposing on someone else.
Yeah, that it's they're free to do it and they're not too close to me doing it.
Tom, any other thoughts you want to share?
Yeah, well, if the United States would live to its founding principles of, you know, peace, commerce, and honest friendship with all nations and entangling alliances with none, then that would have been a step in the right direction. They've got so much blood on their hands in the Middle East right now that trying to fight back against ISIS, they've got a lot going against them. But secondly, as far as the propaganda coming from ISIS, a lot of it is religious arguments based on the Quran and such things. And there's flaws that you can point out, but hold it. You're talking about the government coming up with a counter campaign, and now you'd be talking about the government coming up with a theological discussion, pointing out the flaws in the theological arguments being offered by the Islamic State. And that's not the role of the federal government in the United States, is to teach people religion.
That's true.
You're absolutely right there. And I would say that actually, to the extent that they're doing that, they're establishing a form of Islam as being the official American version of Islam, which A, may well not be attractive to a lot of Muslims, but also it violates the First Amendment.
Thanks, Tom, for the call tonight. Go ahead, Rich. You can continue.
That's the other way to violate the First Amendment, you can interfere with somebody's free exercise or establish religions.
And the toll-free number, if you want to join us here for your thoughts, 855-450-FREE. It's interesting he brought up ISIS. I actually had seen this story, and it was late at night, and I didn't mark it for show prep, but he just reminded me about it. There is apparently a new threat, alleged threat from purported ISIS jihadists. This is from Randy DeSoto at westernjournalism.com, where they issued threats against the United States on Tuesday of this week, indicating the group has trained soldiers positioned throughout the U.S. ready to attack, quote, any target we desire. The online post singles out controversial blogger Pamela Geller, one of the organizers of the Draw the Prophet Muhammad cartoon contest in Garland, Texas, over the weekend, calling for her death to, quote, heal the hearts of our brothers and disperse the ones behind her, unquote. ISIS also claimed responsibility early Tuesday for the shooting, which marked the first time the terror group claimed responsibility for an attack on U.S. soil, according to the New York Daily News. The post allegedly from ISIS reads, quote, "The attack by the Islamic State in America is only the beginning of our efforts to establish a wilaya, an authority or governance in the heart of our enemy. As for Geller, the jihadist state, quote, to those who protect her, this will be your only warning of housing this woman and her circus show. Everyone who houses her events, gives her a platform to spill her filth, are legitimate targets. We have been watching closely who was present at this event and the shooter of our brothers." ISIS further claims to have known that the Muhammad cartoon contest venue would be heavily guarded, but conducted the attack to demonstrate the willingness of its followers to die for the sake of Allah. The FBI and Department of Homeland Security, in fact, issued a bulletin on April 20th indicating that the event would be a likely terror target. They drew their message to a close with this ominous threat, quote, "We have 71 trained soldiers in 15 different states ready at our word to attack any target we desire."
71 soldiers? It's like a street gang, but smaller.
Yeah, really divided street gang all across 15 states. Out of the 71 trained soldiers, they claim that 23 have signed up for missions like Sunday. "We are increasing in number," they say. Of the 15 states, we will name 5, Virginia, Maryland, Illinois, California, and Michigan. The next 6 months will be interesting. So are you scared?
I'm not scared at all. And frankly, you know, this Geller woman, yeah, what she did was offensive and rude on one hand, but you do have a basic human right to be offensive and rude. And, absolutely, you know, I'm not shedding a single tear that two people who are willing to kill people over speech are dead, mm-hmm, any more than I would be sad if a couple of terrorists who tried to take out flag stompers were killed in that pursuit.
Well, apparently they had this event in Texas, but I imagine if a similar event happened in a more gun-free zone, things would have worked out a little differently. 855-450-FREE. Hold that thought, Rich. We'll come back. It's Free Talk Live.
I walk my dog every day, and I've got the best-looking dog in the neighborhood named Stanley. He's a collie mix. We meet the same people every day. They'll tell me, oh, he's so soft, and he's so silky. And these dogs that have the brittle hair, it's coarse. It doesn't lay nice. It's not shiny. It's dull. I tell them about Dynavite.
DINOVITE.com.
859-428-1000.
The omega-3 fatty acids.
Flaxseed, zinc, alfalfa.
The digestive enzymes that are cooked out of regular dog food.
Sundance's coat was shiny and glossy the way it had when she was a puppy.
We get asked all the time at shows,
how do you get your dog so healthy and shiny and glossy?
It didn't take very long. They've got their nice, expensive jogging suit on, and their dog has their smooth, beautiful, soft, shiny coat. So now their dog looks just as good as they do.
859-428-1000.
859-428-1000.
DINOVITE.com.
Making the right decisions is a challenge to investors. Are we going to see economic growth slide into a recession or, at worst, depression? Hi, Ted Anderson from Midas Resources. We all know when a company acts irresponsibly, divesting ourselves in a move towards safety is prudent. When the market becomes volatile, U.S. Treasuries are a safe haven. But what do you do when the U.S. government overextends itself and spends beyond its means? Many investors are turning toward gold as a common-sense alternative to traditional paper investments. Midas Resources has put together a powerful book titled 10 Reasons to Own Gold, discussing costs, benefits, risks, featuring full-color illustrations, weights, and measures. The book is free and can be yours by calling 800-686-2237. Paper investments are dwarfed by gold's 6,000-year history. Discover how gold may be right for you and your IRA by calling 800-686-2237. Whether buying or it's time for you to sell, the book is free. Call 800-686-2237.
Free Press Publications is an independent, alternative media and publishing company founded in June 2009 with the mission of ensuring a free press for the freedom movement and is committed to spreading the message of peace, freedom, love, and liberty. FPP also gives new authors an avenue for publishing freedom-oriented material. FPP brings you daily news and commentary on the website fpp.cc, as well as a daily 5-minute newscast, FPP Radio News, and weekly news, views, and commentary in the FPP Freedom Minute and Peace, Love, Liberty Radio at fppradio.com, and the monthly newspaper FPP News at news.fpp.cc. Find FPP online at fpp.cc. That's fpp.cc, as in Creative Commons.
You can listen to Free Talk Live on the radio, podcast, satellite, webcam, and our live streams. But did you know you can listen to Free Talk Live from any phone, anywhere? Add this number to your phone, 213-493-0308. It's a long-distance call, so make sure you're familiar with your phone's calling plan. The Listen Lines are airing the latest episode of Free Talk Live 24 hours a day, including our live shows. Call 213-493-0308. That's 213-493-0308. LRN.FM needs your help getting our satellite signal back on in Africa. Our satellite provider had us on at no charge from 2012 through February of this year when they pulled the channel off the air. Now we're trying to raise $22,000 to continue reaching people with the message of liberty in places where it's needed most. Please visit our Indiegogo fundraiser at africa.lrn.fm. Give what you can and share the link with your friends. africa.lrn.fm.
You can watch the LRN Studio Cam and chat with other listeners anytime at cam.lrn.fm. That's cam.lrn.fm.
This is Free Talk Live. ISIS has, or at least people claiming to be ISIS, have released some threats against 15 U.S. states, claiming they've got 71 trained soldiers in 15 different states, and of those, 23 have signed up for missions they claim that will be similar to what happened in Garland, Texas, with the drawing Muslim or drawing Muhammad contest, and the idea being that Americans should be very afraid. And
they're going to be launching more abject failures if it's going to be like the mission in Texas, where a couple of guys came in, shot somebody in the foot, and immediately got blown away, which I don't find that impressive. You don't win a war by dying for your country. You win a war by making the other poor bastard die for his country.
Yeah, and of course, as we pointed out a moment ago, Texas, there's some relative gun freedom in a place like Texas. So I wish the people in Illinois and California the best if ISIS follows through on their threats here. They did name Maryland, Virginia, Illinois, California, and Michigan as potential targets for some sort of continuing attacks. So I guess stay tuned as that situation develops. And also stay tuned over at freedomsphoenix.com, where every day they're uncovering the secrets and exposing the lies. Readers of freedomsphoenix.com are constantly provided the detailed real news that lies between the lines of propaganda and the relationship we have with coercive governments. They offer up-to-the-minute updates on the economy, technology, communications, and the rise of the police state. You go to freedomsphoenix.com and sign up for their free daily dispatch. Again, that's freedomsphoenix.com. And I got to say, I'm not afraid either. Rich Paul, you said you aren't afraid of ISIS.
No.
You're not afraid, Danica, of ISIS?
It's just kind of like anonymous. Everyone claims to be them. Although they could potentially draw the threat, but I don't know. 71, I'm not afraid.
It's a funny thing that they would name numbers like that.
Yeah, 71. Like, how precise? Like, are they going to put one on the south end of town? One on the...
It's a very small number, and you're right. It is a strange thing for them to do. I mean, why not just say we have an untold number or dozens
make up thousands,
right?
Yeah, we have thousands in Chicago waiting for you.
Yeah, so it's an interesting claim. It's an interesting tactic. I got to say, if I'm going to be frightened about something, I would be more frightened about the U.S. government, and they are the
There's
ones.
There's a lot more than 71 of them.
Oh, yes.
Probably 7 million of those people. So there's a lot of government guys out there, and many of them have guns. Many of them are willing to wield those weapons over us and put us in cages if we don't agree with their particular religion. Because ultimately, there really isn't much of a difference to me between ISIS and the U.S. federal government. They both have crazy religious beliefs, and they both are willing to kill for their religious beliefs. The religious beliefs of the U.S. federal government is the belief that, you know, they are God, essentially, that, you know, the government is something that should be worshipped, and the government has a set of rules that should be obeyed, and it has symbols, things like the flag that people should pray to.
Oh, the flag.
And I find this to be very disturbing. These government people have been responsible for far more killings than the entirety of ISIS in its history.
And I'll tell you, a lot of the people who are loudest about condemning Muslims over the fact that they would kill somebody who was doing something insulting to their prophet, a lot of these people are then now posting things on their Facebook wall with the flag stomping protest and, oh, just let me see you do that, I'll beat you like a redheaded stepchild. So it's okay so long as they do it in defense of their religion of statism,
right,
or their religion of Christianity. They just don't want other people behaving like they do.
Double standard, for sure.
Such a double standard.
Yeah.
So you can share your thoughts on ISIS or whatever you want, but let's go back into the story, or actually jump into the story here about the Christian swingers, since we're still talking about religion. This is related from a website called ChristianToday.com, which I suspect is a legitimate website. It certainly looks, this looks pretty legitimate here.
Look at that photo. It has a watermark and everything. That's pretty legit, man.
The watermark? What is it?
The watermark on the picture.
Okay. I don't know what that's, the X run or
something. It's the watermark on the pictures.
Do you know what that is?
It's just copyright. It's just like, this is the company that took this picture.
Right. Yeah, yeah. I don't know if that has anything to do with
I'm making
Christian
a joke
today.
On the, it looks like it's legit. Because he said, it looks like it's a legit site. And I said, they're totally legit down to the picture.
I don't know if that's their picture, though. I think that might be the people who are from
Probably
Florida
not, but
here,
they're using a quote-unquote legit picture.
Right. For me, what defines whether or not it's legit is the other content on the site, and it does look as though it's a Christian website. Anyway, Carrie Lodge writes here at Christian Today, a devout Christian couple from Florida are championing an unusual evangelism technique, swinging. Christy and Dean Parav met online 8 years ago and began swinging after being approached in a do-it-yourself store. They now regularly swap partners.
Oh, a do-it-yourself store. What kind of do-it-yourself store?
I guess they didn't want to do it themselves.
Is it a hobby store or an adult store?
Good question. I'm not real clear
I've
on
never
that.
Heard a do-it-yourself store.
They now regularly swap partners with other couples. And while most would regard sexual promiscuity as conflicting with their religious beliefs, the Paraves, who both compete as bodybuilders, believe they can use their newfound connections to share the gospel. Dean told Barcroft Media, quote, God has put me here to spread his word, and our lifestyle community is a great place to do it. You can't get closer to someone than having sex with them.
Right. Okay.
He believes that he's been given a unique opportunity to share
that statement alone is just horrific. You can't get closer to somebody than having sex with them. It's like, have you never experienced any real intimacy in your life? I'm sorry, but...
He believes, well, I don't know. It would be a good question to ask him. He says he's been given this unique opportunity to share his faith with those who might otherwise never hear about Jesus. He said, I'm getting to people that will probably never even visit a church. Quote, God's not going to put a lion with a bunch of elephants, so what's he going to do? He's going to put a swinger with a bunch of swingers to spread his word. Simple as that. Quote, if all the swingers are sinners, what's the best way to talk to the sinners? To join them, right? It's an unconventional pastime for a Christian couple, but the pair insist they have a mutual understanding. Christie explained, quote, I don't think God would be mad at what we're doing. At first, I was conflicted, but the more we looked at it, the more it makes sense to us. Dean and I, she says, are both in agreement with this lifestyle, so we're not committing adultery. God put people on the earth to breed and to enjoy each other, and I feel God is always with me, and he has put us here for a reason.
Well, at least they're consenting to it. That's a nice touch, I suppose.
Yeah, I mean, I don't consider that if you're in a polyamorous relationship, which obviously they are, then certainly I would not consider sex outside of that relationship as being adultery, because you're not violating the terms of your actual relationship.
Right.
Yeah, I think this is interesting because obviously it flies in the face of standard Christianity. But I'm wondering what other Christians out there think about this.
But who decided in the first place that adultery was sex with anybody that you're not married to? That's not the common usage of the word.
Right. Adultery is cheating, is, being dishonest.
Exactly.
That. So share your thoughts here. Toll free, 855-450-FREE. They've got themselves a website, fitnessswingers.com. There's more on the way here, and you can share your thoughts on Free Talk Live.
KatieArmor.com is your one-stop shop for the most affordable body armor, period. With packages starting at $169.99 and free shipping on every order. Katie offers soft armor and rifle threat rated armor up to level 4. Go to KatieArmor.com and get your body armor today while you still can. Mention this ad and receive a free tactical scarf for a limited time with any body armor package. That's CATIArmor.com. Come and take it.
So I say to Mark at lunch, look, you know, I keep hearing from the government that, you know, they're worried someday ISIS may get here. And I go, duh, Garland, Texas, Muhammad cartoon shooting. ISIS is already here. I'm not waiting for these people to defend me. If they don't know ISIS is here already, they got no clue. I'm taking care of myself. Guns80.com, AR-15 kits, 30-shot magazines, great prices. They've even got the Hillary special. Guns80.com, that's 844-2-GUNS-80, Guns80.com.
On Free Talk Live, we're bringing people to the ideas of liberty every day. From wrestling superstars like Glenn Jacobs.
You guys really are having an impact, I believe. Like I said, a lot of where I am now is due to listening to Free Talk Live. You changed my mind on some very important issues years ago.
To random people tuning in on the radio.
I was kind of stuck in the left-right paradigm. I heard your show by chance on a Saturday night. From there, I went on, joined the Free State Project and become an amplifier. So, I mean, that's really the reason why I amp is because I know that if it wasn't for you guys being on as many stations as you are, I never would have found the ideas of liberty.
Your amp will directly change more lives by getting Free Talk Live in front of people looking for talk radio online and on the air. You can help by joining the AMP program for just $5 a month at amp.freetalklive.com and getting perks. That's amp.freetalklive.com.
If you want to move to the free state and you're looking for some real estate.
Oof, I think we've all had enough of that jingle, don't you? If you're going to invest in property in New Hampshire, it just makes sense to support a liberty-friendly realtor. Call Mark Warden of Team Porcupine Real Estate for investment property or rentals in the Free State. Or visit his website. Come on, you know it.
PorcupineRealEstate.com.
Did you know that you can listen to and watch Free Talk Live during our live show 7 days a week from 7 to 10 p.m. Eastern via our studio cam at cam.freetalklive.com? Not only that, but you can also chat with other listeners at the same time. Do I need to mention that both the studio cam and chat room are totally free? Outside of Free Talk Live's live hours, you won't see a cam feed, but we'll hear audio from the Liberty Radio Network. So listen, watch, and chat all free at cam.freetalklive.com. That's cam.freetalklive.com. Are you looking for an excuse to come check out New Hampshire this fall? You're invited to Keenvention. Keenvention is your chance to meet dozens of key Liberty activists from across the Shire. You can explore the beautiful little city of Keene, discuss various forms of activism with seasoned veterans, do some Robin Hooding, and learn about making the move. Keenvention received rave reviews last year. If you missed it, visit keenvention.info for full video coverage of every speaker and panel. This year's keynote speeches and panels will be announced via the Keenvention blog and Facebook, so stay tuned there for the latest. Join old and new friends and neighbors in Keene for Keenvention this October 30th through November 1st. Tickets are available now at a special early bird price of just $50 via credit card or Bitcoin. That $50 price only lasts through the end of June, so don't delay. Reserve your tickets now at keenvention.info. Visit keenvention.info for more and look for our page and event on Facebook. That's keenvention.info.
You're listening to the best Liberty-oriented audio streamed around the clock, on the air, and online. This is the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM.
We're back with more Free Talk Live. You can share your thoughts here toll-free. Can one be a swinger and a Christian at the same time? There are a couple of Christian swingers who are making the news, at least on ChristianToday.com. They've got a website, FitnessSwingers.com. They're into bodybuilding and swinging. And they basically
and
say...
And spreading the word, apparently.
And spreading a few things, it appears. But that's, you know, they feel like this is their mission, apparently, to go and connect with other swingers and then somehow spread to them the word of Jesus. It's certainly a bizarre situation. You're welcome to comment here at 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. We've got Skype as well. Skype on into the show here at username lrn.fm. And of course, you can get interactive online at freetalklive.com. When you're online, you should be protecting yourself, and ProXPN can help you do that. They've got a way to encrypt your data connection, and it's a global virtual private network, so you can connect to their servers around the world if you've got their premium account. But you can go and get their free account right now at proxpn.com/FTL. They've got an app for Windows, Mac, iOS, Android, Linux, so whatever operating system you're using, you can go and grab that over at proxpn.com/FTL. And get started. When you're ready to upgrade to their premium account, you get the servers around the world, unlimited bandwidth, private torrenting ability, plus you can get past regionally blocked websites, and the most important thing, your internet connection will be encrypted, so your ISP won't be able to save your surfing history anymore. Criminals will not be able to sniff out your Wi-Fi packets. It's a great level of protection available to you for less than $5 a month when you use code FTL50, which gives you 50% off the price of the annual account. That's code FTL50, which, by the way, locks you into that savings for the lifetime of your account. Use that code over at proxpn.com/FTL, where you can get started and get a great discount on privacy that is priceless. It's a risk-free 7-day money-back guarantee, and ProXPN does not keep records of your online habits at all. We're talking about the fitness swingers here. Their Twitter account, according to ChristianToday.com, reveals a rather bizarre mix of swinging resources, Bible verses, and links to worship songs. They insist that they remain committed to a single goal, however, saying, "If I can go to the next swingers event and get 10 people to believe in Christ, my job is done," says Dean. And it seems like that would be an awkward time to have a conversation about religion when one is in someone's stranger's bed.
I would have to agree with that. I think that would be the last thing that would be on one's mind.
Well, one of the ideas, one of the things that the Church of the Invisible Hand stresses is the importance of contact between people, and mm-hmm. that's why we hope eventually to have temple prostitutes, because there is, although I obviously, to me, emotionally emotional intimacy is a much closer thing than physical intimacy. Physical intimacy is a need and a spiritual need for people.
That's true.
It's been shown that if you take babies and you don't touch them, even if you meet all of their other needs,
right.
frequently those children will die. So I actually
or
have some sympathy
psychos.
With these guys or become psychos. And I certainly have a hard time developing social skills and future mating rituals. I've always thought that, you know, issues that I've always had with like flirting and striking up relationships and games might well be related to the fact that I spent my first 2 months in an orphanage. And so I probably did not have that early contact. And it seems like it all works through the limbic system, and that, you know, the timing behind peekaboo, the timing behind dancing, and the timing behind exchanging glances during flirting displays all seem to be related to that limbic system, which maybe doesn't work as well if you don't get early contact.
Yeah, I think that what you're saying there is really, really important. And there are those studies, and it's pretty clear that if you're not loved and touched specifically by your parents, then that will result in some very bad things that will happen to you later on. And so what you're saying, Rich, is that the Church of the Invisible Hand, which is your church, which you founded, you're talking about, you know, providing a place and a service for people to get that physical contact that is so necessary to being a human being. Mm-hmm. However, that would put you at some risk, right? Like, I mean, that's an interesting thing. Has that ever been done in America before by a religion to have such a thing as a temple prostitute who is, you know, there to service the members of the church?
All I can think of is temple virgins, not temple prostitutes.
Well, there have been temple prostitutes in various religions throughout history. Various Greek cults had them back when Athens was the preeminent center of the world culturally. There were various cults. The cult of Aphrodite, I would imagine, was one of those where there were temple prostitutes. I don't know if it's been tried in America. And frankly, in order to limit the risk, I would want to start with offering unlicensed massage as a service of the church. And I think under New Hampshire law, that would actually be very safe because the massage statutes have an exception specifically for spiritual healing.
Oh, interesting.
And that exempts things like Reiki, but I believe it would also exempt a church-sponsored massage that was administered at least partially for spiritual purposes. And that's the kind of thing that scares me about the law that the gentleman called in about earlier, is
the
technically
one that would
under that law, if I didn't report my unlicensed temple prostitutes to the authorities, I would lose my tax-free status, which obviously that's not going to happen.
Yeah, I mean, as far as I'm concerned, if whatever's going on in your religion is a victimless crime, it's nobody's damn business, and it should be part of the religious freedom of that organization.
Absolutely. And it would be nice if it was just part of your general pursuit of happiness and you didn't have to tie it to a religion. But, you know, if you have to jump through the hoop of tying it to religion to get it, then being able to get it that way is a lot better than not having that liberty at all.
Now, you founded the Church of the Invisible Hand. Where can a listener go to learn more about it?
Right now we're mostly a Facebook page. So if you search on Facebook for Church of the Invisible Hand, you will find us and, give us a like and, We have some content coming out through there, and eventually, as soon as I get somebody to send me a clerical collar to wear while I'm doing it, there will be sermons being put online. I just want a nice priest collar.
This can't be very expensive. Just the collar portion? I mean, the rest of the suit.
Well, I might need a different shirt to go with the collar. I don't know if it will work with an ordinary dress shirt, but from what I saw online, it looks like it might be like $30 or $40.
Just curious, what color would you do your sermons in?
Actually, I would want to have the three colors that I think would look really sharp, at least on me, would be black, charcoal gray, and purple.
Okay, so you've got the overshirt or whatever, and then the collar. So what color would the collar? What color would be the overshirt?
The collar would be white, and once I get to the point where I can afford it, I want my collars to be white collars embroidered with a gold dollar sign.
I see.
After some of the estimated profits.
Actually, it's an allusion to the dollar sign stamped cigarettes from Atlas Shrugged.
Oh, wow.
They also had a gold dollar sign stamped on their cigarettes, and I thought that was pretty cool.
That's a nice touch.
So look up Church of the Invisible Hand on Facebook to get more information and stay in the loop with what Rich is up to. Our toll-free number here tonight is 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. In other news, or news that we didn't finish in the first hour, there's Ripple that has been hit now with a $700,000 fine. It's the first fine levied against a digital currency, and that's not good news. There's more coming up here in moments. It's Free Talk Live.
There are two types of advertising. Pull advertising, like Google AdWords, where a consumer goes looking for widgets near them and you try to pull them in with your ad away from the other widget purveyors. Then there's push advertising, where you push your message out about your great widgets and attempt to convince people who weren't thinking about widgets at all that what they need in their life right now is your widget. Radio is push advertising. In the course of a week, there are probably over 250,000 good folks listening to Free Talk Live, and they could hear your message. We're having a sale right now, and it ends May 15th. 200 30-second ads for $1,997. That's like $10 an ad. Find another show with that kind of rate with 150-plus stations. Email me, markedge@freetalklive.com, and I'll set you up. You don't need to have an ad. We'll produce it for you. Buy 200 30-second ads by May 15th and get them for less than $10 a piece. It's a big savings, and you don't want to miss it. Email me, mark@freetalklive.com, now.
It's time to build your own emergency food stockpile with the industry leader, My Patriot Supply. Once you try them, you'll know why so many Americans like you have made them part of their emergency preparedness plan. Experience the My Patriot Supply difference today with this unbelievable offer. Right now, a 4-week food supply is only $99, and that includes free shipping. That's 50% off the online price. Call 800-274-3070 to claim yours. Limit to per caller while supplies last. This offer isn't available online, so you want to make sure and grab this opportunity to get prepared today. 800-274-3070 to get your 4-week food supply for the incredible price of only $99, and it'll be shipped to you completely free. Call 800-274-3070 right now. That's 800-274-3070 to claim yours while supplies last. Don't wait. Call today.
Cato University is the Cato Institute's premier educational event of the year. It's being held this year from July the 26th to the 31st at the Cato Institute's state-of-the-art headquarters in Washington, D.C. This annual program brings together outstanding faculty and participants from across the country and often from around the globe, with everyone sharing a commitment to liberty and learning. Cato University is a genuine community, and you can freely share viewpoints, concerns, ideas, questions, and more in an atmosphere of friendship and personal respect. It's a one-of-a-kind program for people who don't stop thinking after they got out of school. It's for people who don't want politicians or bureaucrats or officials to do their thinking for them. It's for people who value liberty. You'll learn, you'll be inspired, you'll make new friends, you'll meet great people from around the world. All of the details are spelled out at the Cato website, cato.org, and they hope to see you there this summer, July the 26th through the 31st in Washington, D.C. Again, details are at cato.org.
The three most important things you can do for Free Talk Live are, one, share one episode a week on Facebook or in some other social networking site. Two, buy the things you buy online through shop.freetalklive.com. Three, give $5 a month to the AMP program. You likely buy all kinds of things online. Amazon is the largest online retailer. You can get what you need at the same prices with free Super Saver shipping by going to shop.freetalklive.com. Please do your online shopping at shop.freetalklive.com.
Are you tired of governments murdering people around the world? Stop using their money. There is an alternative. Bitcoin is a stateless, free market, non-political currency. Bitcoin cannot be inflated or controlled by any government. By using their money, you are helping the state. Stop doing it. You have an incredible alternative available now. Learn it, use it, spread it. Get started with Bitcoin at weusecoins.com. That's weusecoins.com.
While our satellite channel is free to listen to, it's not free for us. You can help us cover our satellite costs with the chip-in on the right side of the page at lrn.fm.
This is Free Talk Live. Dial in toll-free. Join us here on the air at 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. You can join us online, drop on by freetalklive.com, and enjoy the features there that are waiting for you. That again, freetalklive.com. With you in studio, you've got me, Ian.
Rich Paul.
And Danica.
And let's see here. We were talking in the first hour, got into a story about Ripple, which is a company that sort of, they created their own digital currency. And I can't really speak from a lot of personal experience with Ripple. It was a turnoff for me because it was a company that was behind it that made it kind of like...
So it wasn't truly decentralized.
Well, right. I don't know how their system works, but they have a currency called the Ripple, I guess, called the XRP. And this is a virtual currency. But yeah, I guess you're right. They're not claiming it's decentralized. They're just saying it's a virtual currency.
Mm.
So Bitcoin is a virtual currency as well, and a more popular one. XRP, the Ripple here, is second most popular in the world, but it's second by a long margin. And they aren't decentralized, whereas Bitcoin is. So Bitcoin being decentralized means that there's no company that's in charge of Bitcoin. There are people who build Bitcoin. There are the developers of Bitcoin.
And the miners that mine the Bitcoin.
That's right. But anybody can be a developer of Bitcoin. It's open source. And, you have to, I'm sure, do there's probably something that you have to do to, kind of get included within whatever the inner circle is of the main developers. But, it's an open source project. Anybody can go and put in time on this. Ripple is a closed situation. That's a company that operates Ripple, Ripple Labs, as they're called. And now they've been targeted by FinCEN, which is the Financial Crimes Enforcement Network in the United States, for a $700,000 fine. They're claiming that Ripple Labs qualifies as what is determined to be a money services business, which makes them subject to all sorts of regulations, like the Bank Secrecy Act, which requires these suspicious activity reports to be filed on anybody that's doing business with a transaction of over $2,000 that the company determines to be suspicious. And this is typically something you hear about in relation to banks, where banks will send one of these SARs, or suspicious activity reports, or cash transaction reports, where they, if you give more than $10,000 in cash to a bank or request more than $10,000 in cash, they'll fill out a cash transaction report. And all of this information goes to the government so they can pick on people and harass them. So I guess it's a good thing that Ripple didn't do that stuff initially, but unfortunately they're now being targeted for it. According to the story over at SovereignMan.com, in the age of the USA Patriot Act, suspicious transactions are big business for Uncle Sam. Last year, a record 2.4 million suspicious activity reports were filed in the United States, and that's 40% more than were filed in 2013.
Wow.
So from one year to the next, they went from 1.7 million to 2.4 million suspicious activity reports, which means that could be you, by the way. You could be one of the victims of these reports, not even realizing that what you had done was suspicious.
Mm-hmm.
So going and making a deposit
on a regular basis of a specific amount is something they consider to be suspicious. They call that structuring. The idea being that you're trying to avoid the cash transaction reports. Let's say you've got $10,000 and you want to put it into the bank and you know about the cash transaction report, so you don't want to trigger one of those. So instead, you take your $10,000 into five, you know, $2,000 payments.
Yeah, or you know, $1,000 per, you know, per week or something, you know, just very slowly.
Right. And then, you know, if the teller notices a pattern that looks suspicious, they have to fill one of these out on you. And before you know it, the Treasury Department could become knocking at your door, maybe even freezing your bank accounts and cleaning them out. According to the complaint, Ripple Labs failed to register with FinCEN as a money services business, nor did it submit so-called suspicious activity reports. In its complaint, FinCEN described several of the oh-so-nefarious violations. According to FinCEN, quote, in January 2014, a Malaysian-based customer sought to purchase XRP from Ripple Labs, indicating that he wanted to use a personal bank account for a business purpose. Holy Jihad Batman, says SovereignMan.com. Someone wanted to use a personal bank account for business purposes? Nuke the SOB. I mean, seriously, he writes, this is the complete nonsense that keeps financial bureaucrats up at night. Some guy in Malaysia wants to buy digital currency with his personal funds. Whoop-de-doo. But what's really wild is that Ripple actually denied the transaction. They just didn't file the suspicious activity report.
Huh.
So even though Ripple didn't actually engage in said suspicious activity, failing to file the SAR was enough to land them in hot water. The end result? Ripple has been dinged with a $700,000 fine.
Now, that's an important thing to think about when you're doing business in Bitcoin. If they had not denied the transaction, there would be no way of establishing that they had noticed it and determined that it was suspicious. There would be no way of knowing that they were aware of that it happened at all. But because they were paying attention and because they denied that transaction, then you can come back and say, you knew there was something wrong with that transaction, and the evidence is that you denied it. So the money changers in the temple at the Church of the Invisible Hand also operate under the seal of the confessional, and they are forbidden to notice what the customers are doing. Just don't pay any attention. They reach a spiritual meditative state, in which case that sort of thing just passes right through them without concern.
Now, $700,000 is a pittance compared to the $9 billion that BNP Paribas was slammed with last year for doing business with countries that were former enemies turned best friends of the U.S. government, namely Cuba and Iran. But it's still a ridiculous penalty for having done nothing wrong. Of course, it's never about right or wrong. It's about sending a message. And that's exactly what FinCEN is doing. By going after Ripple, which is a major player in the the virtual currency community, FinCEN is trying to scare all the smaller players into ratting out their customers. And this, after all, is what desperate, bankrupt governments have been doing for millennia. Step one, track down where everyone's money is. And step two, take it. You don't see rich, stable countries doing this sort of thing. In fact, the exact opposite. An official from Hong Kong's treasury recently stated that, quote, the government does not consider it necessary to introduce at the moment new legislation to regulate trading in such virtual commodities or prohibit people from participating in such activities. Night and day difference. We'll continue to see these steps in the U.S. and in Europe, tracking down virtual currency transactions, banning cash, anything they can do to keep your money trapped in the system where they can keep their eyes on it. It's all the more reason to move a portion of your savings out of that system and into somewhere safe. Our goal is simple, to help you achieve personal liberty and financial prosperity no matter what happens. And that's the folks over there at SovereignMan.com. So I can't say I'm I never was a fan of Ripple. I never really did get it, why it was necessary, why people really even care about this particular virtual currency, what makes it so useful, why is it even anything that is worth talking about aside from Bitcoin. And now it's even less interesting to me because it's now been, you know, proven that once again, having a centralized company behind something like a new technology like this virtual currency is a danger to the currency itself. If Ripple gets shut down, they're not shut down. They've just been fined $700,000. Right. But if they close their doors, what does that do to their virtual currency? It's going to go away, right?
Mm-hmm. Just like Liberty Dollar. Liberty Dollar did the same thing. A 1 ounce silver coin is a 1 ounce hunk of silver. And as long as you treat it as just that, there's no centralization involved. Basically, all you've got is the reputation of the mint guaranteeing that the composition of the coin is what it's claimed to be.
Mm-hmm.
But as soon as you start stamping dollar signs on the thing and trying to brand it as Liberty Dollars, then you can get into legal trouble.
How long would you say Ripple had been on the market? I know Bitcoin had kind of been around since 2009. How long has Ripple been around?
It's been around for a while. I mean,
I think it's older than Bitcoin.
You think
isn't
so?
Really?
Okay.
I think so.
Interesting. It could be. Honestly, I don't know. It's just one of those things that I've seen before. I know it exists. But
I seem to remember reading something about it, like maybe in the late 90s.
Oh, really? Okay.
But maybe it's not that old, but I think it's older than Bitcoin.
So it's had a while to build up its reputation. Yeah, if it gets completely shut down, where's all that going?
Right. How do you make a claim on it? Because right now, that you mentioned Liberty Dollar, Rich, there's a situation where the government came in and they confiscated all the Liberty Dollars that were in the vault, if you will, in the mint under guard, supposedly. Which of course the guards just let the government agents in and let them clean the place out.
Well, what are you gonna do? Die for $25 bucks an hour?
No, of course not. So a lot of good all the guards did.
Right.
And so now you got the government with all these pieces of silver, and now supposedly they're gonna let people have a shot at getting them back. But personally, I don't trust that. I think they're trying to go after the people who want those Liberty Dollars. More coming up.
New Hampshire is under quarantine as walking corpses devour the flesh of the living. Max is 11 years old and surviving alone. Slow-moving and non-thinking, the dead swarm his home. Now he must apply his Porcupine Freedom Scouts training to improvise his escape. Look for Survivor Max on Facebook, read reviews on Amazon, or read Chapter 1 at SurvivorMax.com.
Inventory is everything. Products sitting on shelves is money sitting on shelves. Managing our inventory is key. That's why I use KeepStock Solutions from Grainger. KeepStock Solutions help keep just the right amount of inventory on hand. KeepStock Solutions help keep the cost down. KeepStock Solutions keep me a happy camper. What's the key to better inventory management? KeepStock Solutions from Grainger. Get it? Got it? Good. Visit Grainger.com/KeepStock for more information. Grainger, for the ones who get it done.
Liberty activists around the country are starting to realize politics alone won't set us free. So what will? At Liberty on the Rocks, we believe the answer starts with living your principles, spreading ideas, and connecting with those around you. By starting a Liberty on the Rocks network, you can make a difference by uniting libertarian thinkers. Find out how much fun it is to build your local network from the ground up. Visit libertyontherocks.org today to get started.
If you want to know the latest about Free Talk Live before we go on the air, all you need to decide is how you want it delivered. It's your choice. Visit news.freetalklive.com. You can get emailed announcements and participate in contests via our email updates list. Plus, we have a Twitter account that you can follow and a Facebook page where you can become a fan. So visit news.freetalklive.com to get news about Free Talk Live as soon as it's announced and the way you want it delivered at news.freetalklive.com. That's news.freetalklive.com.
You're listening to the live edition of Free Talk Live. Hour number 3 is next after the news here on the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM.
From Keene in the Shire, the Liberty Media capital of the world, this is Daryl W. Perry, host of FPP Radio News for Friday, May 8th, 2015. Silver is trading at $16.29 per ounce. Gold is valued at $1,182 per ounce. And according to BitcoinAverage.com, the average price of Bitcoin is $239. Antiwar.com reports in a 98-1 vote, the Senate yesterday passed a bill that will give them veto power over the P5+1 nuclear deal with Iran. The lone no vote was from ultra-hawkish Senator Tom Cotton from Arkansas, who was angry that his amendments were not approved. The bill has been somewhat watered down from what was initially proposed, and President Obama had said he will sign it, though at this point the overwhelming majority is veto-proof anyhow. The House of Representatives will be the next to debate the bill, with a vote expected there next week. Though there probably will not be any serious obstacles to the vote passing there either, it could face another round of attempts to add amendments aimed at killing the negotiations outright. Senate hawks are expressing hope that even this watered-down bill will effectively do that anyhow, saying they believe that Congress would not approve the deal as presently written and will insist on improvements that will themselves almost certainly be unacceptable to the rest of the nations involved. The lone senator to abstain was Barbara Boxer from California.
FPP Radio News is brought to you by Coinbase. Coinbase is a simple and secure online Bitcoin wallet for sending, receiving, and storing Bitcoin. Get started at coinbase.fppradio.com. That's coinbase.fppradio.com.
UPI reports a federal appeals court ruled the NSA's collection of telephone metadata on millions of Americans is not authorized by the USA Patriot Act, making it illegal. The SCOPE program was first uncovered by whistleblower and former NSA contractor Edward Snowden in 2013, sparking a debate about privacy, security, and the reach of government surveillance. The court ruled in response to a lawsuit filed by the American Civil Liberties Union, arguing the metadata collection violates the privacy rights of Americans. The NSA collected telephone metadata under the authority of Section 215 of the USA Patriot Act, which allowed for secret court orders to collect tangible things that could be used by the government in investigation. The USA Patriot Act was enacted after the September 11th attacks to combat terrorism. Section 215 expires on June 1st. The court wrote, "The text of Section 215 cannot bear the weight the government asks us to assign to it, and does not authorize the telephone metadata program."
For over 35 years, Roberts & Roberts has been a trusted source for buying and selling your investment-grade precious metals. They also take Bitcoin for precious metal purchases and permanently removed the minimum purchase order for all orders paid in the digital currency. Call Roberts & Roberts today for knowledgeable advice on investing and a forward-thinking approach to new technologies. 850-478-5270 or online at rrbi.co.
Reuters reports Prime Minister David Cameron's Conservatives are on track to govern Britain for another 5 years, even though they are likely to fall just short of an outright majority at Thursday's election, according to exit polling. The poll gave the Conservatives 316 of 650 seats in the lower house of Parliament, and the main opposition, Labour Party, is expected to receive 239. If accurate, that would be one of the centre-left Labour Party's worst ever results. Conservative Government Minister Michael Gove said that if the exit poll proved correct, the Conservatives have clearly won this election. Such a result means Britain is likely to face a historic in-out European Union membership referendum in the next 2 years, and that billions of pounds will be cut from government spending to eliminate the budget deficit in the world's fifth largest economy. UK election exit polls have a good track record, but the large number of parties competing this time has raised the potential for error. It will be well into Friday before final results are announced. The poll, conducted by Britain's national broadcasters, suggests Cameron will have multiple options to form a government, perhaps with the support of either the Liberal Democrats, his current coalition partners, or Northern Irish Unionists, or both. He could also try and go it alone. The same poll said the Scottish National Party would win 58 of Scotland's 59 seats, all but wiping out Labour in its former stronghold. SNP leader Nicola Sturgeon said the exit poll's prediction should be treated with huge caution. This has been FPP Radio News, online at fppradio.com.
Frustrated with his increased workload and a litany of interpersonal problems, CLG software project manager William Garston brought a list of grievances Thursday to his supervisor Todd Watkins, an utterly powerless office functionary with no actual ability to resolve any problems.
Oh, no. I'm really glad that you're bringing this to me. This is great.
The 15-minute interaction, which was taken seriously by both parties, involved Garston laying out a series of work-related issues he's had recently, absolutely none of which Watkins has even the slightest authority to address.
Again, I'm sorry to be bothering you with all this stuff, Todd. I've reached a point where this is important. We're gonna sort all this out.
Sources added that throughout the conversation, Watkins continually nodded his head and repeatedly assured Garston that his problems would be considered a top priority, despite the fact that he lacked the necessary clout to foster any change whatsoever within the company.
This is the Onion News Network.
This is Free Talk Live. We're launching into the third hour here. Plenty of time for you if you want to dial in toll-free and join us on the radio waves at 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. Coming up, the update on the story about the young man who was left in a cell for 5 days by DEA agents with no access to food or water. This is a story we talked about when it initially had occurred, and now there is news about it, and it's not good news. We'll get into that here in a little bit. Also, if we get the chance, the first road legal self-driving big rig. It's here, and this is going to be a game changer for the logistics business. The moving of products from one point to another has traditionally required a driver, and that's about to change. So that's all happening here. It can happen here tonight. Of course, you can also happen as well. You can get on the phones and join us here toll free at 855-450-FREE. Whether you want to talk about stuff we've already discussed here tonight, including Christian swingers, the NSA being smacked down by the Second Circuit Court of Appeals, or at least part of the NSA being smacked down, and temple prostitutes. We've covered a lot of different things here tonight. With you tonight, by the way, it's Ian.
Rich Paul.
And Danica.
Danica, you had a story out of Florida that you wanted to share with us tonight.
Yes, that is correct. A Central Florida woman who was issued a driver's license that mistakenly labeled her a sexual predator said Thursday that she plans to file a defamation lawsuit against a county tax collector's office. Now, Tammy Lemasters of Claremont said that she was denied service when trying to book a room at a hotel and has endured funny looks from cashiers when cashing checks because of the blue letters in the bottom right corner of her license that says sexual predator. She purportedly did not notice it until almost 3 weeks after she noticed the mistake.
Okay.
And this is interesting because, one, we've got the DMV being stupid and not paying attention to what they're doing, but also, why did she not look at, like the description says, the letters are in dark blue. They, you know, stand out on the Florida driver's license.
You've seen a scan of it or a picture of what
yes,
it looks like?
Yeah, there's a scan and picture of it. It clearly says it. So even at a quick glance, which I would assume normal people would do after looking at their licenses, after renewing them, making sure that everything looked fine,
yep,
would catch her attention, right? I mean, is that so hard to really think about?
I've been walking around for several weeks with a new debit card in my pocket that had never been activated until yesterday. Sometimes you just don't have time to check things out. I mean, you're busy.
But if you get a debit card, it's got a sticker on it that says call by activating it right away. So it tells you can't use it until you actually activate it.
True. And I knew that was there. I just hadn't gotten around to actually
dealing
with
it. Sure, but you knew that you probably couldn't use the debit card until you activated it, right?
Yeah, I probably knew that.
Yeah. So it just kind of baffles me how this woman didn't, you know, take a quick glance at her license and this, oh, hey, something is seriously wrong here. You need to fix this.
Well, I mean, I can see where Rich is coming from in that, you know, you presume things are going to be normal, right? Like, you've been sent this updated license. You take it out of the envelope. You throw it in your wallet. You don't give it a second thought. I mean, even though we know that people can make mistakes. Certainly state bureaucrats are
you know, commonly able to make mistakes, and in most cases,
right?
I
agree.
Normally, the thing that I would look at would be how did the picture come out.
And so would
these days, they hold
people.
The picture in a database, and you will get several successive licenses frequently with the same photograph.
That's so true.
At that point, I might not even notice anything else on the license. I might just throw it in my wallet.
Or if you're a girl, you're looking at the picture saying, oh, what a horrible picture, and demand to take another one. But I mean,
it is fairly obvious. I pulled up the article, and we'll post it on our Facebook and Twitter here in a
little bit. But yeah, it's pretty obvious. Like, it's not a, you know, blurred out. It's not a, it's a very contrasting color,
right,
and contrasting font.
Everything else is
font.
Black. All the other fonts is black, and this is the only text that is appearing in blue on the front of this license.
And so here's the, and so she went to the tax collector's office Thursday, accompanied by her attorney and television cameras, to get a new driver's license almost 3 weeks after she first noticed the mistake. Like, I get going to the DMV takes a long time and is super frustrating to sit in for any DMV, but 3 weeks after you notice it, come on.
I'm confused.
Well,
about
she also had to hire that lawyer and obtain those television crews, and neither lawyers nor television crews are necessarily that quick to obtain.
Yeah, that's true. So what you're saying is that there were 3 weeks where she used this license,
right,
and then when she noticed it, it was 3 more weeks before she actually went in?
No, it says here almost 3 weeks after she first noticed the mistake. So she probably took the license, went home, and when she tried to use it, because she has had to use it in her daily life, she was denied from booking a hotel. She was turned away from a theme park. She had trouble picking up her kids. Like, she probably noticed it soon after it had happened, probably after she got home and tried to do business with it. But you brought up a good point saying that she probably had to hire a lawyer and TV crews to get this noticed. But 3 weeks, come on. I mean, it just seems like an absurd amount of time.
Well, what I'm curious to know is how long it went from her getting this license to where she first noticed.
Yeah, it doesn't.
How long did that take?
It doesn't say when she first noticed it. It just says that she's never been charged with a sex-related crime whatsoever. So 3 weeks after she had initially caught the mistake is when she finally started to actually process the lawsuit.
Got it.
Let's see.
Do you have more?
Yeah, it's right here. Lou Masters called the tax collector's office 4 days. Here we go. 4 days after discovering the mistake, and was told to come back to the office right away so the problem could be fixed. So it had been. So it says she called it 4 days after discovering it. So she discovered it, but she didn't do anything about it.
Well, like Rich said, she lawyered up before she went to the tax collector's office. So she was doing something about it. She was planning her approach for this lawsuit. Which, by the way, I consider it to be a pretty weak case. I mean, she's basically suing because there was a mistake made, but ultimately, you know, was she... I mean, what kind of damages did she really take from this? Besides some people looking at her funny and maybe drawing some unfair conclusions about her, I don't know what she's suing for, how much money she wants out of them, but to me it would seem to be that her standing is relatively limited and the potential for compensation is also fairly limited on this.
The issue that I take up with this is that not only did the DMV totally mess it up and taking a while to correct it, obviously, they're not paying attention to their mistakes. They checked the wrong checkbox for it, which seems like that it would be pretty obvious that they were checking. But that it just...
So it was the DMV that checked the wrong box?
Yeah, they checked the wrong box for it. Like, she wanted to be a donor. That was it, yeah. She wanted to check it as a donor. And, you know, O is right above sexual predator because she wanted to be under organ donor.
No good deed ever goes unpunished.
Oh, man.
Yeah, so this poor woman, I mean, can you imagine having to go try to cash a check, try to book a hotel, try to pick up your own kids, and get denied several of these everyday services because you're labeled a sexual predator.
All right, so it does say here in the story, I've got it pulled up, that she didn't notice the mistake until several days after getting the new license. She had to go to the traffic court for a ticket and notice the judge and bailiff studying the license quizzically. Afterwards, when she was at a store, she noticed the sexual predator label and immediately had tears in her eyes. So basically, she went for a few days with this.
And that's the point that I'm trying to make. How in the world could she have missed this? I mean, it's pretty obvious.
Well, she missed it for a few days. I mean, the the question is, you know, is this worth anything? Is her inconvenience and the strange looks of people and whatever thoughts that might be going through their heads something that you can actually collect on in a civil lawsuit against the state?
I'm curious just how much she's trying to seek in damages. She was denied a hotel stay, so how much did that cost her for not being able to stay at a hotel?
Ah, okay. I didn't realize she was denied that.
Yeah, and I mean, to me, the big thing would be the humiliation when you realize.
Absolutely.
I mean, it's like walking around with your dick hanging out of your pants.
Yeah, I don't know if we're going to let you get away with that one, Rich. Sorry about that. We'll come back with more here in moments. 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. There's more on the way here. And what is the, you know, appropriate punishment here for the state? What should be done? Should they, you know, have to give this lady some money? And what's the appropriate amount? You can share your thoughts here at 855-450-FREE. This is Free Talk Live.
Are you completely free of stress and fatigue? Well, of course not. You aren't alone, though. Now think about how nice it would be to begin relieving some of that stress and fatigue. Let me introduce you to a product that has and is working for me. It's called Youthful Greens. Youthful Greens. It's packed full of nature's nourishing, cleansing, and alkalizing greens, providing a powerful dose of whole food nutrition in each serving. Youthful Greens helps increase overall energy levels and reduce all that fatigue and stress on your body. And right now, when you visit freegreens.net or call 800-333-6923 and order your 1 month supply of Youthful Greens for only $29.95, you get another month's supply for free. That's 2 months of Youthful Greens for the already low price of just $29.95, plus free shipping. That's saving you $45. Visit freegreens.net today or simply call 800-333-6923. And hey, you're welcome.
Gold, it's like nothing else on Earth. From the Romans through the Renaissance, from the Industrial Age to the Space Age, gold has weathered the test of time. For 6,000 years, gold has remained the ultimate store of wealth. According to the World Gold Council and the U.S. Mint, demand is at an all-time high. The stage is being set for the reemergence of gold as the common-sense alternative to a fiat paper currency that gets weaker every day. Midas Resources is proud to offer the hard-hitting report that arms you with the truth you need to protect you and your family from the Fed's plans for your hard-earned money. Don't gamble with your future. Call Midas Resources today and ask for your free copy of As Good as Gold. Call 1-800-686-2233 for the report the Fed hopes you'll never see. As Good as Gold can be yours by calling 800-686-2237. If you have ever thought about owning gold, you must read this report. Call Midas today at 800-686-2237.
There are two types of advertising. Pull advertising, like Google AdWords, where a consumer goes looking for widgets near them and you try to pull them in with your ad away from the other widget purveyors. Then there's push advertising, where you push your message out about your great widgets and attempt to convince people who weren't thinking about widgets at all that what they need in their life right now is your widget. Radio is push advertising. In the course of a week, there are probably over 250,000 good folks listening to Free Talk Live, and they could hear your message. We're having a sale right now, and it ends May 15th. 200 30-second ads for $1,997. That's like 10 bucks an ad. Find another show with that kind of rate with 150-plus stations. Email me, markedge@freetalklive.com, and I'll set you up. You don't need to have an ad. We'll produce it for you. Buy 200 30-second ads by May 15th and get them for less than $10 a piece. It's a big savings, and you don't want to miss it. Email me, mark@freetalklive.com now.
Here's a chance to do a little activism while you're cruising Facebook, Twitter, or Google+. Between the LOL cats, the recipes, the hot girls, and the inspirational sunrise memes, Free Talk Live's posts pass by your newsfeed. Like them. Comment. It gives us more exposure. If you don't see our posts, click like at facebook.freetalklive.com and then hover over it to click get notifications. It's an easy way to spread the ideas of liberty a bit further. I know you're busy, but you can spare that tenth of a calorie it takes to click on something. Facebook.freetalklive.com.
New Hampshire is under quarantine as walking corpses devour the flesh of the living. Max is 11 years old and surviving alone. Slow-moving and non-thinking, the dead swarm his home. Now he must apply his Porcupine Freedom Scouts training to improvise his escape. Look for Survivor Max on Facebook, read reviews on Amazon, or read Chapter 1 at SurvivorMax.com.
Do you love Twitter? Make sure you favorite the LRN.FM Twitter account so you can receive our tweets at twitter.lrn.fm. That's twitter.lrn.fm.
Back with more Free Talk Live. We'll take your calls if you dial in toll-free. 855-450-FREE is the number. That's 855-450-3733. And joining you in the studio, you've got Ian here.
Rich Paul.
And Danica.
Coming up, July 8th through the 11th, Planet Hollywood in Las Vegas is going to be the destination for Freedom Fest, the world's largest gathering of free minds. Mark, our normal weeknight co-host, is going to be attending Freedom Fest, and I think this is going to be his third one, and he would like you to join him there at the World's Best Liberty Conference. It's titled Discover the New American Dream, and it's going to have a historic debate. Krugman versus Moore, the number one Keynesian versus the number one supply sider. That's right, Paul Krugman has been invited and apparently has accepted the invitation to debate economics at Freedom Fest.
I want to see that.
Yeah, it's going to be pretty big. And of course, there's all kinds of other names there, like, oh, I don't know, John Stossel, perhaps, Steve Wynn, John Mackey, as well as Steve Forbes. So many big names at Freedom Fest. You can go to freedomfest.com to learn more about the event. It's going to be happening July 8th through the 11th at Planet Hollywood in Vegas. You can also call them toll-free at 855-850-FREE. That's 855-850-FREE. Or go to freedomfest.com. Look forward to, Mark will look forward to seeing you there.
Does Mark need a co-host to go with him? Because I'm available for that duty.
I think that there was an original pitch made to send Free Talk Live out as a broadcasting live kind of package, but I don't think Freedom Fest went with that option, so they're just getting Mark this year, so he will not be broadcasting the show from there. So we're going to continue doing episodes of Free Talk Live here in Keene as Mark goes out and enjoys Vegas all by himself.
So, oh, what a pity.
Yeah. Freedomfest.com. Go and grab your tickets there and get more information. So, Danica, you were sharing with us a story out of the Associated Press in Orlando where a lady is pretty upset. She's suing the Department of Motor Vehicles or the tax collector, one or the other. I'm not real clear to whom the lawsuit is filed against.
You know, that's really interesting because I noticed that too when I was reading it, that she is suing the tax collector, but the DMV is the one that issues the driver's license. So how are they connected?
In Florida, it's different. Don't you get that from the tax collector in Florida?
You would know, Ian.
Well, that's a good question.
That's what I seem to recall. I remember at least getting license plates from the tax collector,
right.
And I think it was driver's licenses too.
I think you go to the DMV office to get the driver's license, but yeah, you definitely do get your plates through the tax collector. And the tax collector and the DMV have some sort of relationship in Florida. I don't know for sure what that relationship is. It's been too long since I've dealt with that.
Gotcha.
Renewals, by the way, the license plates and the renewals of like your tags and the stickers for the plates, that all goes through the tax collector. I remember cutting them a check every year for that. Mm. But as far as the actual license is concerned, I'm certain I went to DMV territory for that. So why one's being sued versus the other, I don't know.
Okay, so you get a driver's license through a tax collector. Okay, I mean,
No, you're pretty sure you get it through the DMV. What you get through the tax collector in Florida is the plate and the renewals for that plate.
Okay. The reason why I brought up the story is, not only is the tax collector totally messed up by putting something absolutely horrific on her driver's license, but just this woman didn't notice it for several days afterwards. I can get that people are busy, people don't pay attention. It just kind of baffles me how you don't even look at your driver's license, because you need your driver's license for a lot of things, unfortunately. I mean, ID is everything nowadays, and it just puzzles me how she just could not even look over and see, and you very obvious words. It's
It says sexual predator in blue in the corner of her license. So are you saying, Danica, that you don't feel like she has a legitimate case here because it's some responsibility falls on her as the holder of the license to verify the work that was done on it?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think ultimately it's the tax collector's issue because they're the ones that messed up in the first place. I'm just saying she's partially to blame too because she was kind of dumb and didn't really pay attention to it. And if she had paid attention, a lot of embarrassment could have been avoided. It all comes down to personal responsibility and looking after yourself because no one else is going to do it. This woman is an adult. She has three teenage kids.
And she's never been charged with any sexual
crime.
Never
been charged with it whatsoever.
Her attorney, John Phillips, said that when you have sexual predator on your license, do you really think someone's going to give you the benefit of the doubt over a government agency? They are not. The manager, however, of the tax collector's office, where she claims she got her license, so maybe you do that at some places. Maybe where there's no DMV, the tax collector handles that.
Maybe she
was in a rural county
It could be a really small one. It is just out of Tampa. So
the manager at the license office says it was human error. She said, or Mark O'Keefe said, quote, "We said we fully understand the embarrassment she faced, but these are humans doing a human job. People make mistakes. When we find them, we move swiftly to correct them." When drivers get new licenses, they're told by workers in the tax collector's office to double check that everything on the ID is accurate.
Sure, I've been asked that with my ID. Haven't you? Probably.
I don't recall. Probably. LeMasters called the tax collector's office 4 days after discovering the mistake and was told to come back to the office right away so the problem could be fixed. The bureaucrat says if you misspell Main Street on a driver's license or put the wrong initial on their name, people are back here in a half hour, if not the next day, to have it corrected. Both the bureaucrat and the attorney for the lady theorized the mistake was made when the wrong drop-down box was checked on the driver's license computer. Right. The motor vehicle agency software is being updated, and one of the changes being proposed includes adding a pop-up window that would ask workers issuing the licenses whether they are sure whether they're clicking sexual predator. So apparently that pop-up does not exist right now. So it could easily be an accident to check the sexual predator box, and there's no verification that, hey, wait, did you mean to do that? You could be ruining someone's life.
Right, exactly. And I totally agree that it was human error. You know, I believe that blame falls on both parties in this case. And in any case, as far as her getting any sort of
compensation,
she should probably get back whatever she paid to renew her license, at least. And maybe whatever else she was
supposed
to be charged.
Attorney's fees.
Now that this has been made into an attorney's case, absolutely. But she shouldn't get millions. That's kind of silly.
What do you think, Rich?
I don't know about millions, but if I was a juror, I would cut her some thousands.
A few thousand bucks, several thousand.
Yeah, I would cut her something, I think.
Yo, well, you can share your thoughts here with us here tonight, 855-450-FREE. Of course, it raises the larger issue of the sexual predator designation in the first place and how many people have this designation on their licenses when, in point of fact, you know, maybe they didn't actually act in a predatory manner towards someone. I wonder, is Florida applying sexual predator for everyone who's on the sex offender list? If that's the case, then that would also mean that someone who has, you know, peed behind a tree in a park.
Right.
Or this couple that just got busted having sex on the beach.
Mm-hmm. That's right. That those people would be considered sexual predators. And to me, a sexual predator is not the same thing as people who are engaging in consensual acts or in, you know, acts involving relieving oneself. 855-450-FREE. 855-450-FREE. There's more Free Talk Live coming up.
Quantitative easing, unemployment at depression levels, Europe financial system falling apart, China getting out of U.S. treasuries. At the end of 2008, the time of TARP, the national debt was at $11 trillion, gold trading around $850 per ounce. Close to 2012, the national debt exceeded $16.4 trillion, gold doubled to $1,600 per ounce. The $20 trillion threshold for the national debt is inevitable. Politicians in Washington have a ferocious appetite for spending and stimulus. What's worse, a printing press to finance. 100 years ago, we had a gold standard to limit this madness, but now you have to adopt your own gold standard. Don't be fooled with paper promises. Get Midas Resources 10 Reasons to Buy Gold free by calling 800-686-2237. Understanding the gold and silver market may be the only insurance you could have to avoiding the next economic crisis. Call 1-800-686-2237 and order your free copy. Again, that's 800-686-2237.
Following morning reports indicating that Philadelphia High School for the Performing Arts student Samantha Bylum deals with really weird social pressures on a daily basis, Onion reporters met with the 16-year-old dance student who described feeling regularly alienated from her peers for extremely bizarre reasons.
If you're not up to date on the latest urban street art or Esperanza Spalding albums, the other students will eat you alive. It can get pretty brutal. Just the other day, everyone cut class to go watch the Million Dollar Quartet musical at the Forest Theater, but nobody told me. Now I'm the only one that hasn't seen Lance Guest's rendition of Folsom Prison Blues. It's humiliating.
According to Bylum, the school year shows no sign of letting up as she continues dealing with the everyday stresses of auditioning for the school's production of My Fair Lady, keeping up with the latest punk Afrofusion dance groups, and not having enough fishnet sleeves to wear throughout the week.
Honestly, I don't know how the other students deal with it.
Keep checking theonion.com for more as this story develops.
This is the Onion News Network.
I love My Magic Mud. I drink a lot of coffee. I had stains on my teeth. Then I found My Magic Mud, and I was told it would remove stains. So I paid attention when I brushed the first time. My Magic Mud is black tooth powder, and the difference it made in my teeth in one application was noticeable. With four, my teeth were as white as you normal folks out there. Please go to MyMagicMud.com and buy a jar. There's 150 applications for $25. You can use Bitcoin. MyMagicMud.com.
So you've heard all 3 hours of the latest episode of Free Talk Live, and you're still hungry for liberty-oriented audio content? Did you know that we have another 24/7 audio stream at LRN.fm? The Liberty Radio Network airs the latest episodes of some of the best liberty-oriented podcasts on the internet around the clock. In addition to recorded content, you'll also hear live shows like Free Talk Live, originating from our Keene, New Hampshire studio. So listen anytime at LRN.fm. That's LRN.fm. What if the key to achieving liberty in your lifetime was to move together with others who think like you? Liberty activists are joining the Free State Project, which is over 70% of the way to its goal of 20,000 participants. And they're already making the move to New Hampshire. The successes are piling up and are proving the Free State Project is a real movement and no longer just a great idea. When you're planning your move, consider Keene. Keene is famous for its civil disobedience and non-cooperation, and there's plenty of political opportunity as well. From demonstrations and vigils to outreach and volunteering, there's a lot going on in Keene. Keene is the Liberty Media capital of the world, with television, talk radio, and more, all originating here. Though it's more than just activism, with regular social events each week. See what's happening at freekeene.com and get connected with video, audio, free books, a forum, and activist tools you can download and use in your area at freekeene.com. That's freekeene.com.
Listen to LRN.FM on any phone, anytime. 213-493-0309. That's 213-493-0309.
Free Talk Live. You can dial toll-free here, 855-450-FREE is the number. You can join us on the air. You can join us online over at freetalklive.com, where you can get interactive, and you can support Free Talk Live by supporting our satellite fundraiser, which is going on for about 9 more days. And you can help that out by going to africa.lrn.fm. That's africa.lrn.fm. Contribute whatever amount is appropriate for you. You can enjoy some of the perks that are available and also feel good because we can get the message of liberty spread to the African continent via free-to-air satellite with your help over at africa.lrn.fm. You can continue to comment, if you'd like, on the situation in Florida with the woman who was issued a license that said sexual predator on it in bright blue lettering that was particularly obvious if you were looking at the front of the license, but apparently she didn't notice it for several days after she finally noticed getting strange looks from people when they would look at her license and then ultimately being denied a hotel room. She then figured out
that she had the word sexual predator accidentally printed on the front of said license. And so I was curious, was sort of wondering aloud, was there a difference between sex offender and sex predator? Turns out there is. The Broward County Sheriff's Office says, and I don't know if this is true of every state. Maybe it's just a Florida
thing. Just a Florida thing.
I don't know. But according to this, you are a sexual offender in Florida if you are convicted of a sex offense involving a minor who is, let's see, offenses include but aren't limited to child pornography, sexual performance of a child under 18, and a person procuring a person under 18 for the purposes of prostitution. A predatory designation requires that a person be convicted of a first-degree felony sex crime or two second-degree felony sex crimes, and that which occurred after 1993. In addition, the court must issue a written order finding for predator status. So both sexual offenders and sexual predators are required to register their address with the Florida Department of Law Enforcement or the local sheriff's office. And then there's more information about the registration requirements and such. There's also a searchable database of both sexual predators and offenders. So I don't know if sexual predator is the only thing that can be written on a license, or do they also write sexual offender on a license as well? It does sound like sexual predator is the more severe of the two statuses. So if you know more and you want to share it with us, please join us here at 855-450-FREE. Let's go to Richard on the line. Richard, you're on Free Talk Live. Hello, Richard, on Skype. Going once. Richard on Skype, going twice.
Oh,
that was really awesome. Great call. All right, so 855-450-FREE is the toll-free number here tonight. You look confused, Rich.
I'm just wondering what that sound was.
I believe that was a fart noise.
Okay. Did that come from you or
no,
from him?
No, that was from Richard.
That was
okay, I was wondering if that was your Skype, I just flushed this call sound. And if so, I was thinking that's probably a little inappropriate. But if it was him, there's nothing you can do about it.
Not a whole lot.
I do have a toilet flush sound effect, but no, I didn't really think about running that.
Well, thank you for sharing your intelligence and depth with us, Richard.
Yes, I hope that was worth the wait. So the toll-free number, 855-450-FREE. Here's an update on an awful story that we reported on here. I think it's probably a couple years ago. Yeah, 2012. Daniel Chong, this story from the LA Times at latimes.com. Daniel Chong was a UC San Diego student, and he was detained in 2012 for what he was told would be 5 minutes after he was swept up in a drug bust at a friend's house where he'd been smoking marijuana.
The horror.
Instead, agents forgot about him. Chong, who was 23 at the time, drank his own urine to stave off dehydration until he was found delirious and suffering from severe breathing problems, according to a report last summer by the Justice Department Office of the Inspector General. Obama administration officials and lawmakers are calling for greater accountability and tougher disciplinary procedures at the Drug Enforcement Administration after the agency imposed only light punishments on the agents who forgot Daniel Chong in that holding cell, leaving him without food or water for 5 days and nearly killing him.
A good start might be locking them in exactly the same cell under exactly the same conditions and letting them see what that's like.
No, instead they've just been given a slap on the hand, Rich, and maybe a memo from the boss letting
Don't
them know.
Don't do it again.
Yeah, you naughty, naughty DEA agents, you are having too much fun with your crackdown on these college students, and you got all distracted by
were smoking all their weed
probably,
while it was going
probably.
On.
Or at the very least, they were on a severe adrenaline rush, which is what a lot of these cops are really junkies for. They're junkies for the adrenaline feeling that they get.
Steroids and epinephrine, breakfast of champions.
So after their internal review concluded in March, the six DEA agents involved received only reprimands and short suspensions.
Oh, of course.
Spurring the Justice Department to demand reforms to prevent such mistakes from reoccurring. In an April 28th letter to members of Congress obtained by the LA Times, the Justice Department said that what happened to Chong was, quote, unacceptable, and that the DEA's failure to impose significant discipline on those employees further demonstrates the need for a systemic review of the DEA disciplinary process. So they are acknowledging here that the Justice Department is acknowledging that the DEA and their process sucks and that they, you know, there's a lot to be desired here. But their solution is that they need to have a review. So first, they'll need to form a review board, some sort of committee to, you know, get paid extra to take a look at the DEA's review process. And who knows how many years it will take them to do that investigating. They'll likely have to look at the actual written procedure and then interview many agents that are involved with the DEA as to their experiences with the DEA's process before ultimately coming up with a 500-page report on, you know, what needs to be changed and, you know, when will all of this actually happen? When if they actually come up with any specifics that need to be changed about the DEA process, will it actually be implemented? Will it be in our lifetime? Because I don't know. I don't have any confidence to believe that it will.
I could not imagine being locked up without anything for 5 days. That's so inhumane.
I went on hunger strike for 3 days. I was on hunger strike for 3 days when I was in jail, just kind of to see if I could do it. And
really?
I did, but it was tough. And of course, I was drinking water. I was drinking a lot of water.
Sure, yeah.
Right, they give you access to water in most cells, but this man was being held in just like, I don't know if it was a broom closet or something like that. This was not an actual place to hold a prisoner. This was nothing more than a temporary holding area, and he didn't have water, right? There wasn't even a toilet in this room.
There was not even a toilet in the room?
If there was, I'd imagine he would have drank the water out of the toilet.
Right.
Yeah, I was wondering about that. I was thinking, was the toilet broken? Or because usually, you know, the toilet and the sink are a single piece.
Right.
And there's a way to get water out of that without actual contact with the toilet part.
Right. This was a windowless cell with no bathroom. And he was, by the way, handcuffed behind his back the entire time as well. So can you imagine that?
What? I mean,
wow.
Most of the time when they put you into a cell, they will remove your handcuffs from you at that time. And then if they need to transfer you again from that cell to some other location, they might put you back in handcuffs at that moment. But the intention here, supposedly, was that they were just going to come back for him after a few minutes. But whoops. Six out of six agents who were aware of his existence, all of them didn't pay enough attention to what was going on.
I can't believe that.
Yeah, and they basically went home. I think it was over a weekend or something like that. Here, I'll give you a little bit more information about what happened. Longtime listeners are aware of this story. We talked about this when it originally transpired a few years ago. You can join us here toll-free at 855-450-FREE. But according to the story at the LA Times, the DEA is already under fire for its handling of a scandal in which agents admitted frequenting prostitutes while in Colombia, and complaints over DEA Administrator Michelle Leonhardt's failure to adequately punish the agents in that case led to her early retirement announcement last month.
Let's retire the entire agency. It's about time.
Yeah, it's high time for that. 855-450-FREE. Join us here in the remaining moments of Free Talk Live coming up next.
Help! I'm tied up in my hotel rewards program. I'll never get enough points to make it worth my while.
Never fear. Instant Man is here.
Instant Man?
I'm the America's best value in Instant Man, here to save you with instant rewards.
What do you mean?
Join our free value club and get 15% off room upgrades and late checkout when available instantly.
No waiting, no points?
Just register at abvi.com.
Oh, Instant Man, you and America's best value in saved me. Instantly.
New Hampshire is under quarantine as walking corpses devour the flesh of the living. Max is 11 years old and surviving alone. Slow-moving and non-thinking, the dead swarm his home. Now he must apply his Porcupine Freedom Scouts training to improvise his escape. Look for Survivor Max on Facebook, read reviews on Amazon, or read Chapter 1 at SurvivorMax.com.
It's time to build your own emergency food stockpile with the industry leader, My Patriot Supply. Once you try them, you'll know why so many Americans like you have made them part of their emergency preparedness plan. Experience the My Patriot Supply difference today with this unbelievable offer. Right now, a four-week food supply is only $99, and that includes free shipping. That's 50% off the online price. Call 800-274-3070 to claim yours. Limit two per caller while supplies last. This offer isn't available online, so you want to make sure and grab this opportunity to get prepared today. 800-274-3070 to get your four-week food supply for the incredible price of only $99, and it'll be shipped to you completely free. Call 800-274-3070 right now. That's 800-274-3070 to claim yours while supplies last. Don't wait. Call today.
Since time began, tyrants have taken aim at personal liberties. Now there's a movie that aims back.
The government has no more right to tell us what to put in our bodies than they have to take our guns or tell us what books we can read.
Six drug police were eaten by bears while raiding a marijuana farm.
On your knees, you dirty hippies! Jesus. On your knees!
What's the problem, officer?
Today, many cops who enforce pot laws do so only because it provides them with cushy jobs, good benefits, and a chance to push people around.
I was an undercover narcotics officer. The drug war is nothing but a farce.
The Second Amendment says you gotta keep you and your gat intact.
Guns and Weed, the Road to Freedom. A film by Michael W. Dean and Nima Vadavi.
DVD available now at gunsandweed.com or on Amazon. That's gunsandweed.com. Makes the perfect gift. Remember, that's gunsandweed.com.
Free Talk Live has partnered with Amazon, the largest internet retailer. Imagine a department store category, and Amazon has it. Books, electronics, office products, furniture, jewelry, automotive, toys, clothing, sporting goods, and dozens of other categories. Now you can shop and support Free Talk Live by entering Amazon through our website. Go to shop.freetalklive.com, and Amazon will send us a portion of your purchase. You're going to do the shopping anyway, so remember to enter through our site at shop.freetalklive.com. That's shop.freetalklive.com. Ross Ulbricht was convicted in early 2015 of running the infamous Silk Road Underground Market. The Silk Road was a gift to humanity and helped reduce the harms brought on by drug prohibition. For this good deed, Ross may be spending the rest of his life in prison. His family is planning to appeal his conviction, but they need your support. Please visit FreeRoss.org, where you can contribute via various methods, including Bitcoin. Ross needs your help now more than ever. Visit FreeRoss.org. That's FreeRoss.org.
You can interact with other LRN listeners in our message board at forum.lrn.fm. That's forum.lrn.fm.
Free Talk Live. We have enough time for you. If you want to join us right now, toll free at 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. Skype username is lrn.fm. We're giving you an update on a rarely kind of really scary story that happened to a young man who was guilty of nothing more than smoking some cannabis with his buddies in college. And he was at the UC of San Diego back in 2012 when he was detained for what he was told would be 5 minutes when he was swept up in a drug bust at his friend's house where he'd been smoking marijuana. Instead of 5 minutes, it ended up being several days as multiple DEA agents forgot about him. They left him in a holding cell, which had absolutely nothing in it, not even a toilet, no water fountain. Toilet and water fountain are the common items found in any holding cell in pretty much any facility designed for prisoners. This guy was literally just thrown into an empty room with handcuffs on, with no windows, and left there for multiple days before he was finally found in a very delirious state, dehydrated after only being able to drink his own urine.
Oh my gosh.
I don't know how many times he did that, but I imagine it gets all the more disgusting every single time.
Poor guy.
The DEA is under fire for a variety of different incidents, and this is yet another one. However, the DEA itself has not imposed any kind of discipline
on these agents. All they did was say, naughty, naughty, don't do that again. Hey, you're making us look bad over here, but we got your backs, guys. Don't worry about it. The incident over Chong, that's the name of the victim here, is likely to factor into the search for the administrator of the DEA's replacement. Administration officials said they would search for a new agency head who could beef up its internal disciplinary procedures and create a culture that would hold agents more accountable for their actions. More accountable. More than zero? Accountable.
Okay.
So what are we up to here? 1% of accountability now?
0.1% of it?
Yeah, the new guy is. I'm sorry, Rich. Try that again.
I hope this poor kid got a good settlement out of this.
In fact, he did. We'll get to that part of the story here. That's there's a little bit of good news, and that's the good news. I'll tell you that here in a moment. Let's see.
How it covered all those medical bills that he had. He probably had significant kidney damage.
Yeah, that's a good question. At the same time, several members of Congress, also concerned over the Chong case, have indicated they'll move to give the next administrator more authority over civil service disciplinary rules, which DEA officials blamed for the light punishment in both cases. Chong, who was never charged with a crime.
Oh, imagine that.
Was kept in total isolation with his hands handcuffed behind his back in a windowless cell with no bathroom. Midway through the ordeal, someone turned off the light in his cell, leaving him in complete darkness. Chong periodically shouted for help and at some point slipped out of one of his handcuffs. After he was found, Chong was hospitalized for 4 days. He and his lawyers said at a news conference last summer that he underwent intensive therapy for post-traumatic stress disorder, and the DEA then paid Chong a $4.1 million settlement, which, of course, didn't come from a DEA agent's pockets.
That will not pay for getting all that PTSD out of his system.
Nah, those guys should be working for minimum wage until they personally paid that entire judgment out of the rest of their...
Yeah, they should be fired.
If they're kept at all.
Yeah.
They should be kept working as janitors at the DEA.
Putting someone else's life at risk? Oh, yeah. That at the very minimum would require a termination, I think.
Danica, anything is okay in pursuit of the war on drugs. This is totally fine, this pothead. He deserves what happened to him.
Yeah, because he totally...
All potheads. This should happen to all potheads. They should all be locked up for several days and forced to drink their own urine.
Okay. Hey, Chris Christie.
Christie, what? Oh, he was. I really wish I'd had a sign, because that fat pig is one of the most disgusting human beings. He wants to crack back down at the federal level
on pot, right?
The states that have legalized pot, despite the lip service that the Republican Party likes to give to the 10th Amendment, which
means what?
Well, the 10th Amendment says that any power which is not delegated by the Constitution to the federal government is reserved to the states or to the people thereof. In other words, if it's not in the Constitution, the federal government has no business in it. That's why, in order to prosecute prohibition, they had to pass the, 19th or 20th Amendment. And there's been no such amendment to the Constitution for the drug war, so they have absolutely no authority to do what they're doing.
Last month, the DEA's Board of Professional Conduct issued 4 reprimands to DEA agents involved in the incident and a 5-day suspension without pay for another. The supervisor in charge at the time received a 7-day suspension.
Okay, so for each of the 5 days that this kid was locked in a cell,
that's right,
this scumbag DEA agent gets a day off without pay.
So harsh. This is a harsh, harsh punishment.
So harsh.
what's this guy's name? Has anybody doxed these pigs?
Yeah, that's a great point here. They're not naming who these agents are. At least not in this article.
Well, that's probably the first thing that the DEA should do is name them and shame them. And I wonder if a Freedom of Information Act request could get those names, because I'd like to get those out on the internet and see a few hundred thousand phone calls go to these guys. If anybody out there is listening who's affiliated with Anonymous, please get this information on the net.
I love this guy's name. I've seen it before. Rusty Payne, a DEA spokesman, said the Justice Department's Inspector General's investigation into the incident was referred to the agency's Board of Professional Conduct, which recommended the punishments to a top independent official. Under current civil service regulations, the DEA administrator is not permitted to intervene in disciplinary matters. Glenn Iredale, a San Diego lawyer, says the punishments are insufficient. He said, quote, in a situation where someone goes over 4 days without food and water and almost dies, some reprimands and a couple of brief suspensions are not proportionate to the danger that was caused by this misconduct. I cannot accept that the head of the agency was powerless to ensure that there would be appropriate punishment meted out. It may be that the regime of Ms. Leonhardt created a culture of unaccountability. But Payne said the institutional problems that led to Chong being forgotten in his cell have been fixed. He says it was a terrible, tragic mistake and one we have learned from, and we are going to make sure it doesn't happen again. Justice Department officials and lawmakers remain dissatisfied with the DEA's handling of the matter. Well, how do you even know it won't happen again? And if it does happen again, will they give themselves a 2-week suspension? What will they do to show how serious they are about this not happening again, if in point of fact, something like this does happen again?
That's why I'm saying that at the very minimum, they should have been relieved of their jobs for almost killing a human being. Yeah. I mean, part of any major job is attention to detail, and those DA agents definitely were not paying attention to detail.
Mm. Yeah. Of course, then again, there are pigs that shoot kids all the time, and they don't get held accountable either.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, this I just read that a cop who had shot a 7-year-old girl in the head during a during an attempted drug bust, I believe on the wrong address, had just returned to work. How do you somebody like that ever return to a job where they have a badge and a gun? I don't understand.
It is definitely sick. And in this particular case, you know, I guess one of the nice things here, and it's hard to find something nice about this case, but sort of one of the unspoken underlying, I guess, messages here is that they are treating him like he's a human being now, after the fact. Like, they're acknowledging that this person's life is valuable, that there's a $4.1 million judgment against the DEA that, you know, he's being paid. So he's okay, right? Like, after $4 million, that's not a bad payout. And they're acknowledging that this pot smoker is a human being. And for a long time, you know, sort of the official government position of the state is that, you know, that pot smokers and drug users are inhuman, that these are people who are a problem and that they need to be dealt with. But now there's a
hashtag
sort of,
stoner lives matter.
I think so. I think that's the truth. And the fact that, you know, this case has been taken seriously, I think does indicate that maybe people are starting to look at stoners or pot smokers as people who are, you know, human beings, and they deserve to be treated as such.
I think it really just means that they're quite aware that he had him by the
huevos.
Short hairs, and and that they then kissed his, you know, various nether regions.
So hopefully this won't happen again, but I wouldn't get my hopes up, and it's only a matter of time before yet someone else is abused at the hands of the DEA, and I consider anything the DEA does to be abuse to human beings because they ruin lives regularly.
Yeah, the sad thing is the guy never should have been arrested in the first place.
Absolutely true, and we're out of time for tonight, but we'll be back tomorrow. Check out Rich at the Church of the Invisible Hand on Facebook and Free Talk Live online at freetalklive.com. Hey, I'm Ian Freeman, one of the hosts of Free Talk Live. I created Free Talk Live in 2002 as an alternative to traditional talk radio. I wanted a show where anyone could call in and bring up any topic without fear of being screened out. Combined with our libertarian, voluntarist viewpoints, Free Talk Live is a unique syndicated radio show heard on FM and AM radio stations, coast to coast and beyond. I moved from my birthplace of Florida to New Hampshire in 2006 as part of the Free State Project. I'm also the program director of LRN.FM, which I launched in 2009 to create a place to present the best liberty-oriented audio programs from around the globe. I perform liberty outreach of all sorts and have done civil disobedience, non-cooperation, and run for office multiple times. Much of that's covered on my blog at freekeen.com. Thank you for listening to our shows. And if you want to support our work, please visit amp.freetalklive.com and contribute just $5 a month to our effective liberty outreach. That's amp.freetalklive.com.
LRN.FM needs your help getting our satellite signal back on in Africa. Our satellite provider had us on at no charge from 2012 through February of this year when they pulled the channel off the air. Now we're trying to raise $22,000 to continue reaching people with the message of liberty in places where it's needed most. Please visit our Indiegogo fundraiser at africa.lrn.fm. Give what you can and share the link with your friends. africa.lrn.fm.
The three most important things you can do for Free Talk Live are, one, share one episode a week on Facebook or in some other social networking site. Two, buy the things you buy online through shop.freetalklive.com. Three, give $5 a month to the AMP program. It's my firm belief that Free Talk Live's AMP program is the best use of your charitable dollar among liberty-oriented organizations. Support all the organizations you love. But make sure you give $5 a month to AMP at amp.freetalklive.com.
Seditious Sirens is up next, live after the news, on the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM.
From Keene in the Shire, the Liberty Media capital of the world, this is Daryl W. Perry, host of FPP Radio News for Friday, May 8th, 2015. Silver is trading at $16.29 per ounce. Gold is valued at $1,182 per ounce. And according to BitcoinAverage.com, the average price of Bitcoin is $239. Antiwar.com reports in a 98-1 vote, the Senate yesterday passed a bill that will give them veto power over the P5+1 nuclear deal with Iran. The lone no vote was from ultra-hawkish Senator Tom Cotton from Arkansas, who was angry that his amendments were not approved. The bill has been somewhat watered down from what was initially proposed, and President Obama had said he will sign it, though at this point the overwhelming majority is veto-proof anyhow. The House of Representatives will be the next to debate the bill, with a vote expected there next week. Though there probably will not be any serious obstacles to the vote passing there either, it could face another round of attempts to add amendments aimed at killing the negotiations outright. Senate hawks are expressing hope that even this watered-down bill will effectively do that anyhow, saying they believe that Congress would not approve the deal as presently written and will insist on improvements that will themselves almost certainly be unacceptable to the rest of the nations involved. The lone senator to abstain was Barbara Boxer from California.
FPP Radio News is brought to you by Coinbase. Coinbase is a simple and secure online Bitcoin wallet for sending, receiving, and storing Bitcoin. Get started at coinbase.fppradio.com. That's coinbase.fppradio.com.
UPI reports a federal appeals court ruled the NSA's collection of telephone